Level Up Show, episode 11. This week we're going to be discussing difficulty versus accessibility in games. That's our topic of the week. Yes, but there's also a lot of big news stories this week as well.
Cool, really pretty big things that happened, so.
Alright, so do you want to get right into it? Well, let's do a little introductions.
We didn't do
First of all, if you guys don't know, I think a lot of people here, anyone who's in here right now, I would know. But I'm Andrew. This is my fiance. This is what she always does. She has to say your name. Okay.
Really?
Her name is Kristen, because she's obviously a mute right now. She can't speak.
It's funny!
I think this is going to be her theme from now.
Hey, Doug's here.
My brother Anthony's back again.
You see.
Co-host.
Mike.
And producer extraordinaire.
Mark!
Why?
Mark!
Why do I have to say my name?
I'm so excited.
That just would be pleasant, I guess.
It's just funny if I just don't.
Okay. It just gives this awkward pause for like 10 seconds.
Hey, Blueing Gnosis is here. Yeah, it was awesome, man. It really blew us away.
Yeah, so. Awesome theme. We really want to get you something. We will get around.
I'm going to hook you up, so get in contact with Drew on a personal note.
We have to find you a code or something.
I like it because it reminds me of Mario.
Yeah, Blueing Gnosis. Does it have a little bit of Mario jumping in there, stuff like that? I feel like there's some stuff in the background.
There's
from
a lot of, like,
old school gaming.
When he's about to get sucked down the pipe.
Yeah, you can hear like the boom.
Well, he followed what we wanted. We wanted that classic game sound.
But
with a little
I wonder
bit
if he actually used
those
little MIDI effects and stuff like that.
That sounds like something that he actually made all himself, so I'm going to give him the credit on that.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, so we just watched The Walking Dead. We already said we weren't blown away by the episode.
No.
It was okay.
Yeah, it was worth watching, I guess.
Carl's not the best actor. The motion scene had terrible acting, in my opinion, with the dream sequence. Hopefully next week it incorporates a few other characters.
Right.
I get why they focused on two characters, but got a little boring. It felt like a long episode.
It was, well, you know, it didn't feel like, it was nothing.
Yeah.
Just nothing happened. There was a lot of nothing.
Yeah, they need to find like a direction, as I was saying earlier, because if it's just people surviving, it gets boring. It's like, okay, it's just a whole bunch of people surviving. Like, there needs to be a theme, this background, the prison or something like that, and there needs to be a direction that the show is going in.
Blueing Gnosis used chiptunes from NES.
There you go. We loved it. It was awesome. Another thing I wanted to mention real quick, just because I really enjoyed it so much, I watched it with Kristen, was Her.
Don't tell me. I want to watch
it. You still need to watch it, but... Yeah.
Don't spoil anything. Well, probably
it's not going to spoil it.
It's nominated for Best Picture, I think Best Director, Best Actor, Joaquin Phoenix. To give a little synopsis real quick, it's kind of a very... near future where kind of technology has evolved, at least to AIs that are very realistic, and also just people being so invested in their phones that they don't have relationships with other people. They're talking to their phones all day, talking to their inboxes, deleting things. And it does a very, like, it seems to me when I was watching, I was like, this could happen for sure. I could see this happening in the next 10 years. And that's what made it so neat to see Spike Jonze's ideas on where the future was going. But the movie was just really an emotional powerhouse to me. I thought, like, the performances and the direction the movie went in was really impressive. So if you haven't seen Her, that's probably up there with Gravity right now for me.
Yeah.
Am I the only one here who saw it?
I haven't seen it yet,
but I'm really looking forward to it.
Okay,
I really dig the whole, like, semi-future vibes and... It's not so, I guess, outlandish from what I've seen.
Where it's not at all outlandish. It seems like it could happen for sure. Anyone else see any movies this week?
What did I see this week I was going to talk about? Can't remember what the hell it was.
Well, wasn't that important then?
I just recently watched Cabin in the Woods.
Okay, that's awesome. A really good movie.
Holy crap.
Yeah,
that was
awesome,
so good.
Yeah, like, it's really good.
It's probably like my favorite horror movie.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Crazy Alka, we will definitely get to Ground Zero being only 2 hours
long. That's Drew's happiest point of the week.
That could have been my rant this week, but Mike has his own. So I'll rant on that on my own, like, as just the topic. As we get there, you know, just through the news stories. But yeah, that was very... I emailed you on
Gmail. We were talking about it. We were not very happy.
I'm not happy. I'm still not happy because as more and more information comes out, it just gets worse and worse. All right. Let's get into the stories because I feel like starting later now with Walking Dead, it's like we got to get going into it.
So.
We already talked about this a little bit, but let me just reiterate that PS4 firmware 1.6 is out. It adds some very minor features, not the features that people wanted, I don't think.
No, not yet.
One of them, though, kind of. Pulse Elite.
Headset, yeah. The new headset that is coming out, I got to feel, I get to play with it.
Oh, yeah.
It's nice.
Okay.
We had it in the back room, I opened it, so whoever goes to the store I work at and gets the box that was open, that's my fault.
Yeah, it looks very premium. It looks
nice. It's quality. It's very, and the head cups are very comfortable.
Yeah.
Which is nice.
Quickly move through it. It has some stability updates, the ability to mute to camera, and then on top of that, with the new mic, you know, headset thing, there's the ability to download sound profiles, I think they were calling them, for specific games.
Do you know what that means, though?
Meaning that, like, if for Infamous Second Son, they will release a download, which is the exact, like, kind of sound that they want people to hear.
You know how, like, THX has its, its requirements for what you need to have for your audio be like, it's essentially that for games. So, like, Battlefield 4, you want a lot of, you know, pings, you want a lot of, you know, range, whereas something like, you know, Call of Duty, you want it to be closer knit, you know, and, you know, games like...
So if you want to really hear the developer's sound vision, I guess you could
say... Right, exactly what they want you to hear the best way possible.
Yeah, so, that's kind of cool, and I think Infamous Second Son is one of the first games to use that. After that, this is a small story, but definitely worth mentioning.
Yeah, pretty crazy.
GTA 5 shipping 32.5 million units.
And that's only been out since September.
Yeah, and get that shipped, just to say again, but... That's all. That does. That's all that matters to them at Rockstar. It doesn't matter if it's gone to consumers. As long as it's shipped to retailers, they're making the money.
Right.
That's unbelievable.
That's crazy.
I don't think any people really expected it to be that extreme.
No.
And it's just going to keep selling. And you know that when the PC version, the PS4 version, the Xbox One version comes out, it's like they're going to just rake
in
it's gonna, cash.
It's going to destroy, which makes me wonder now. Like I originally was saying it's going to come out, you know, maybe later this year with the Game of the Year edition. I'm wondering, I don't think, we haven't seen anything or heard anything about DLC.
Yet.
I'm wondering if they're just going to bite the bullet this holiday, push it out for...
They've got to do one DLC. I think they'd be missing a big cash opportunity.
But I think they're gonna. I think they're gonna want to get it on all the systems and then make you pay for it all again.
Yeah.
So I think they might be what happens.
Very possible. But I think a lot of people are like, "Oh, Call of Duty has been dethroned." Let's not forget, Call of Duty is every single year.
Right.
I mean,
right.
Like,
well. Right.
No, it's still every single year, but changing the way it's every single year. We'll get to that. But so, yeah, as much as Grand Theft Auto has dethroned Call of Duty in that sense, they're still raking in even more cash because Call of Duty is a yearly iteration type thing.
Yeah.
After that, VR headset, meaning virtual reality, is almost confirmed, really, by SOE.
Which is not something that's too surprising to us because we pretty much knew it was coming.
There was a guy, the president, actually, of SOE, I think he was doing like an AMA kind of thing, Ask Me Anything, and somebody asked this question. Harkening back to the EverQuest Next Black Box video and the bit with Terry wearing the Oculus Rift, are you thinking about experimenting with any other VR solutions in EverQuest Next? So it sounds like Oculus Rift is a potential possibility for EverQuest Next, and the question is, are there any other solutions?
Right.
The guy's response was, hearing good things about two competitors, one of which actually comes from Sony. So I'm thinking this is real, and we may have our snow crash after all. I'm not sure what that last part means. But,
no idea what that's referring to.
Pretty much, that's 100% confirmation right there. Like,
essentially,
a guy from Sony Online Entertainment is saying that he's seen two competitors' versions, and one of them is Sony. Like, he's...
Right.
It's so crazy that he would just come out and say this.
Right.
It's pretty much confirming it. That doesn't mean it's coming anytime soon, I guess, but...
Greg, I'm over you.
Uh-oh.
No, that's a lie.
Okay.
I love you.
I'm not over virtual reality at all.
3D, I can get past, but the virtual reality really is what speaks to me. So.
Yeah, I cannot wait to see what they do with that in the future. And I know, on top of that, I might have to skip this story later, because I'll do it right now. I think it was someone at Valve's showing of their headset, or their VR headset. Because I'm not talking about Oculus Rift right now.
Right.
Valve did their own thing.
Yeah, well, didn't they scrap that though?
They didn't. It's not something that they ever plan on releasing. They were just saying, "Oh, look at what we can do. We can do it better than anyone." Kind of.
Right.
And it was supposedly like unbelievable.
Oh, really?
No, like unbelievable. Better than Oculus Rift.
Really?
Like insane resolution.
So why wouldn't they make
95 frames per second? Just and just insane. And then someone was saying, people that have seen Sony's are saying it's comparable to that.
Jason!
A little late, I see the
beats. Jason!
But someone who has seen Valve's, has seen Sony's, is saying that Sony's is actually comparable to Valve's.
Really?
Which speaks, that supposedly speaks a lot for Sony's,
then.
Yeah.
So
they're saying
awesome.
That it's got that really high frame rate. It's pretty much got like 1080p screens on both sides of your eye. Like it's supposed to be like really high quality,
good.
Which says to me like, God, could this be, again, could this be this generation? I don't think so. And if it is, it's going to be a half-assed version of that.
What, you mean this year or this generation?
This generation.
You don't think it's going to be this generation?
If it is, I think it's got to be half-assed.
Why?
Because they'll have to try, if Sony tries to release it this generation, I think they'll try and hit that $200 price point. And if they're trying to do that, either they're taking an enormous loss,
what would make, or what would make the next generation be, you know, comfortable to putting it at $600 or $700?
Huh?
What would make them want to put it at $600 or $700?
Nothing would. What do you mean? I don't think.
Well, you're saying you would try to put a $200 price point to make it accessible, right?
Yeah.
So you would say that it would have to be more money in order to be quality.
Yes.
So why would next generation be more warranting of a higher price point than this one?
Because by the end of this generation, which is 6 or 7 years from now, then they should probably be able to lower production costs on a VR headset, I would hope.
Yeah, they could probably do it now. They probably could find the right parts.
Maybe.
I would say, honestly, it's going to be a $350 price point when it hits market.
Well, we're forgetting another thing. It's just the power of the PlayStation 4. Who's to say the PlayStation 4 can even support a 95 frame per second 1080p headset? For sure. We don't even know that yet. So it might take PS5 to even have the hardware requirements in order to support a headset of that quality. So that's another part of it.
Sorry, someone just said that we're the group that they want to be with during the apocalypse.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool.
Okay, why?
I don't know. But I'm okay with it.
Because we watched The Walking Dead, so
that's a compliment.
We have all this
stuff.
That's
pretty cool.
Girl in purple, hi, and state your name.
Okay, let's do it again. I'm Andrew.
Kristen.
Mike, Mark, Brother Anthony.
Every time.
Brother, what is he, a monk?
Brother Anthony.
He's my brother, so.
Is he a monk?
Brother Anthony.
Yeah.
I'll take it. I like it.
All right. Let's move on.
Oh my
so that's my thing.
Yeah,
is I
know, I just saw that.
Let's move past it, but I wouldn't rely on virtual reality this generation. Here's a scary story. Ubisoft will not comment on Watch Dogs' Wii U version. Someone has directly tweeted to them saying, what about the Wii U version? Where's it coming?
And, skipping that.
It's open. It's open. Yeah, 50, wow.
Yeah,
60.
That's what I'm saying. I'm like,
what is happening?
Right?
People are watching.
What is happening? Why is there 60 people in here?
We're trying to do a thing where we take more calls. Apparently the Jew forgot all about that, but I care about you guys. So we want you to call in. Call in to us.
We're online.
To him.
If you wouldn't mind, Mark, would you just put our Skype name in there real
quick? Did.
If you guys saw it, we're open for calls at Skype, and hopefully we can talk about some of the news stories that we've already discussed. We'll keep moving forward, keep discussing news stories, but call at any time, because I think they're few and far between. So.
No, that's fine. We just didn't say anything about it. So,
guys are welcome to call. So as I was saying, someone tweeted directly at Ubisoft asking, tell us about the Wii U version. We want to know that this is being made. And they just ignored it. They won't comment on
it. Which is funny, because the Wii U version could potentially be really cool. Like, imagine having that touchpad available for... Sure. I mean, that would be awesome.
Obviously, but who cares if it's not selling?
I agree. I'm just saying, like,
I completely agree.
That would be...
totally fits in
there's
with their
so much potential that you have with that system, with that touchpad, as long as it's used right.
Yeah,
but the problem is nothing is selling well.
No. So...
I mean, the Batman Arkham DLC is canceled.
And this is another example of that, because they've got to be close to done production on this thing. If they, at this point, can this thing... Oh my god, good night Wii U. Like, seriously,
done.
Ubisoft, the guys who pretty much support everybody at launch are turning their back.
And they were the ones that actually said, we want to support. They were actually the main ones that were supporting.
They supported with Zombie U right at launch, although it sounds like they lost a lot of money on that. But they've always been really good with supporting new consoles at launch and continuing to support, finding ways to really find that market. They're usually...
Yeah.
If it means imagine babies, then they'll do that.
Then they'll
do it. Like that, because that was what they did with 3DS or 2DS or something.
Regular DS,
and it did well for them. They'll do whatever it takes.
Also plays on 2DS.
Yes.
That's
so
too bad.
Yeah, if this is true, that's bad news.
Is. I mean, I'm honestly going to say I'm going to start backing up the idea that the Wii is not going to last another 2 years.
No. I wouldn't be surprised.
No.
I'll take that.
So
I'm not going to take a bet on that against you for sure. I think that might happen.
I think we should do more bets. I think that'd be really entertaining. By the
well, what was our one bet?
Does anybody remember what the bet was that we were saying? No. Oh, we said
there was a release of Grand Theft Auto V. I said September. You said October.
Yeah, it was like October 14th for me.
And I said September 12th or something like that. And we bet on something.
Sushi
night. And sushi someone night. One of us is paying.
I think it would be actually more entertaining though if we had like things that come up that we could bet on that we had to do on the show. Like you have to like one of us has to like wear a dress on the show or like, just. No, but I'm not saying like that, but like I'm just saying like something like that.
Okay.
No. I think that'd be entertaining.
Alright, let's move on. Santaya Nadella, I think is how you say his name, is now Microsoft's new CEO. Finally.
We didn't talk about this last week?
No, we didn't. This is this week's news.
Was it really? I guess it was Monday.
It was probably early this week.
What's my gamer tag?
Your gamer tag is the Lost Girl.
Oh, is that what that is? I know what that is.
That's your PSN ID.
Yay, video games!
Although, if you're looking for Kristen on PSN, it's the Lost Girl, but as ridiculous as it sounds, it's not an L at the end, it's an I at the end.
Capital.
So, yeah, it's a capital I, which looks like an L, but it's not. There was the Lost Girl was taken.
Man, feed me.
What, who said that?
Greg.
Oh.
Batman.
Yeah, where's goddamn
Batman? Batman better be here. We keep zeroing out.
Yeah, no,
that's fake. But Satya Nadella is Microsoft's new CEO.
Which is fine, because he had a lot of really big background in the cloud.
He's a younger guy.
Yeah.
He's
40s?
Yeah, he's in his 40s. Not an older guy.
Right, he's not like one of the old heads, like the 65-plus crew that they have going for the most part. So seriously, that's good, because you need that. You need a younger guy with a stable head that has been in, he's been in the company for a while, and he's actually had experience with other companies.
This was like a six-month quest to find this guy.
Yeah.
I feel like. It's been a while. And
more than that, because what's his name said he was stepping down like almost a year ago at this point.
Yeah. All right.
So.
And now, on top of that, people were kind of wondering what would happen with Elon.
I forgot I did that.
Yeah.
That
But Nadella now as a CEO, people are wondering what's going to happen with Elop, because he was one of the big rumors.
Right, and this
and
is one of the biggest news. Yeah,
and because Elop was always a guy that spoke out against Bing and Surface and Xbox.
Yeah.
People kind of
phone section.
Yeah, people were a little bit fearful that if he were to become CEO, he might try to either restructure Xbox or get rid of it entirely.
I feel like this is the biggest troll for like tech ever.
Yeah.
You take a guy who literally denounces a ton of departments and then put him in charge of all of those departments.
That's what happened.
Like,
Elon
I don't understand that. You know, he denounces Xbox, he denounces phones, he denounces tablets, and then you put him in charge of Xbox phones and tablets.
Yep, exactly.
So I'm not understanding what the thought process was behind
it. I think in my head it doesn't say to me that he's going to get rid of any of those because he's now in charge of those. It's like, that wouldn't really make sense. They put him in charge of Xbox and then he gets rid of it. It's putting yourself out of
the way. Okay, and I think we had a really long conversation about what they could do with like tablets, if they did a merger between the tablet with Xbox and everything like that. And they kind of already tried to do that with Windows 8 and Windows 7 even, combining Xbox Live Arcade games and your gamer score. So it has potential to be really cool
To be their PlayStation Now. Pretty much.
Right, and so, I mean, and I even said it to you, imagine the ability to, have Xbox Arcade games or even real Xbox games, playable on the tablet just like you would on the Vita.
Yeah.
There's tablets that are just as capable, if not more, than the Vita is, even though the Vita is a very powerful system. There's tablets that are much more capable, especially ones made by, like, Nokia, and even the internal one by Microsoft, which is now Nokia as well. So you have the ability to have a great portable device with you that can play all these games.
Elop is the guy that kind of a lot of people look at as running Nokia into the ground, though.
Right, which is why I'm so annoyed about this, because merging, no one probably knows, merging all three of those departments together is something new. That's not, they were their own departments. They actually didn't have a phone department before. They do now because they acquired, Nokia. So I'm not understanding why you would make this brand new merger and put the guy that hates all of them in charge of it.
It has so much
potential to be cool, but I don't know. I'm going on way too much.
No,
this was not my rant.
Greg was saying that we're destroying his productivity at work because he's watching me play Don't Starve, and oh my god. Okay.
Work's gay.
Okay. Anyway. So, Batgirl has joined us.
Batgirl?
Okay. Oh, you're looking and you're like distracted. I had no idea what the
you and Mark had
on.
No idea what was happening.
You agree.
And all of a sudden you're just like, Batgirl's shirt, and I'm just like looking at the things trying to see comments, and I just see that. pop up behind us.
Oh my god. Alrighty. So we don't need goddamn Batman anymore. We got goddamn Batgirl here.
There's supposed to be a hole in your cleavage.
Oh my god, that was not
that Batgirl. That was like bronchitis.
First of all, you're not Batman, you're Batgirl, so it's okay. You can
she sounded like Rick from Tonight's Yes,
yeah, really.
Carl!
Carl! Carl!
I noticed it earlier, where I remember that from. No, the Carl thing.
Get the pudding, Carl!
Mama's with that.
Yeah, that's why I said that like that before.
I posted it. Carl!
Oh, your body.
Oh, your body.
Alright, next story.
I hate your accents.
On the PlayStation Now beta, there's been a couple of videos releasing, people showing off the PlayStation Now beta.
Yes.
So there's
this
a bunch
is actually of, relieving for you.
Yeah, there's a bunch of games on there that a lot of people weren't expecting, like Ninja Gaiden's on there, and some PS2 classics are on there. But what most struck out to me was that there were some games on there, and next to them it said disc required.
Right.
Which is very bizarre, because this is something that we kind of talked about that was kind of shut down at one point, but the possibility of putting a disc in, it being able to read at least what that game is.
Which is crazy, because we guessed this.
Yeah, and then being able to stream it because the disc is in the disc drive.
Right.
So that's pretty much what it's saying here, is that if you want to play this PS2 classic, you can't unless you have the disc in the drive.
Right.
Because that's one thing right there. But what if you don't need to download the game digitally at all?
Right.
What if you could play Sly Cooper by putting the disc into the disc drive and it knowing that you own the game?
Almost like it's backwards compatible in a way.
Yes. Full backwards.
No, it is backwards compatible now.
Like, full backwards compatibility. Like, PS1, PS2, PS3, right. Vita, like, everything. Like
everything. That would be awesome.
All right. This isn't confirmed at all, but that just struck me as promising. I was just like, okay, this is cool. That means that the technology is there
right.
to read the disc and not play the game off the disc, but say
right,
this is
emulate
this
and
game.
Read the...
Let's emulate it.
What's going on?
You roasty, have a timeout. Ghost is our moderator again, I guess, this week. Is he banhammering?
I think he banhammered some guy that was being obnoxious. So.
Sad Batgirl.
Oh my god.
All right.
No, we do respond
we
to
We do
viewers.
Respond. We've been responding the whole time.
Wait,
so.
Who's Try Me Kid? What was his question?
Are you
guys seen... hoping to become big was his question.
That
no.
was the question?
That was
I didn't know that.
I mean,
was
I guess that would be nice.
Yes,
that
would be great.
Yeah. I wouldn't reject that possibility.
The new Kevin Pereira and Kevin Smith.
I was going to say Kevin Pereira and...
Someone just asked if I was a virgin.
Morgan Webb? Olivia Munn? Right. What are you? What does that make you in this scenario? I guess that would make you Olivia Munn.
That's
well, no,
fine.
Kevin Smith has his own podcast.
That's
that could
true.
Be Kevin Smith. I'm fat enough. Well, no, not that.
I think your show is all about reaching out to people who want to know about games.
We just want to talk about games.
Yeah, and we want to talk with you. But you guys aren't calling. Call us.
We have our Skype set up.
We have Skype set up, guys. You can call us at the Level Up Show on Skype. It's open right
Allison
now.
Allison Hayslip was so much better than anybody else they put on that show.
I know, right?
And she was from New Jersey.
Yes.
Yes. And they had her on for like, what? I think it was like a month, maybe a month and a half. And that was it. Then she was gone. And she was the best co-host they had on the entire
I really
show.
Liked,
if you say Olivia Munn, I'm going to
no,
punch
no,
you.
No, I didn't have a problem with Olivia Munn,
I
but,
I couldn't stand her.
Candace. I really
I like Candace Bailey a lot.
Candace Bailey was
But nice. Did you watch when Allison Hayslip was on there?
Yeah, I saw a little bit.
I thought she was so much better.
She's a little blonde, right?
She's blonde, but she's more of a game. Like, Candace Bailey was
she's
great.
She's the tech girl.
Greg agrees.
Yeah.
Greg agrees.
Yes.
Yeah, Greg. Olivia,
seriously,
he's got the boobs.
What?
I think he's talking about you having boobs, and that's why you should be Olivia Munn.
Okay. That's fine.
I'm sorry.
No, that's no, I'm fine
honestly,
with that.
I really enjoyed this episode where it was Chris Hardwick and Allison Hayslip.
Oh my god.
Well, I like Chris Hardwick.
Chris Hardwick in anything is great.
I kind of.
Including his.
Don't get me wrong, I liked Kevin, but.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed their
I love Kevin Pereira. I think he's my favorite guy that was on that channel, even more than Adam Sessler. I thought it was entertaining, and if he had gotten given the news and
those are all guys that have been in this industry for a really long time, before it became this.
Did you see, by the way, real quick, and this would be the last thing we talk about before we get off track again. Did you see Adam Sessler, that when they were making fun of G4, after G4 closed?
Yes.
About like a month after when Adam Sessler was like pretending to be like the host of Esquire.
Yep.
That was hilarious. I love that.
Adam Sessler's soapboxes are especially
they're
he usually has some nice little rants there. They're truthful.
Like, I need to actually go back and watch them to get ideas for the rants.
Definitely.
Because he had some great
A lot of people do have problems with voice chat. With Skype.
Why?
That's for some reason.
They have problems with voice chat.
They're
mute.
Shyness.
Or
I mean, would you rather call us on a number? Like, I thought Skype would be nicer than that.
Skype is easier.
First of all, we can hear you better. Everyone can hear you better. It's better pretty much in every way. And you have more an anonymity. Like, you don't get your personal number. I would think Skype would be a lot better for people, but...
All right. Well, why don't we go back to the news? We got a little off topic.
Yeah, but guys, call
in if you can, if you don't feel too shy.
So here's the big story that I think people are waiting for. Metal Gear Solid Ground Zero's mission campaign, rumored to be less than 2 hours long. Supposedly you can get to the end of it in 5 minutes. You can just go right to the end in 5 minutes if
Wait,
you want. Really? Yep. It's five minutes. Getting the former said, like, yeah, you can beat it in 5 minutes if you want. Like, you can literally just go to where you want to go to the end part of the mission, and you're done. Or you can look around a little bit, spend your time with it, get a little bit of like an hour and a half in there if you want, do some side missions, maybe get 3 hours in there.
Really?
Yes.
I didn't read the whole article.
Yes, it's that it keeps getting worse and worse as time goes on.
Really? I didn't see that part.
Game Informer, like, editors keep coming out and saying like little tidbits about it.
Right.
Like saying like, yes, it is very short. Like, they've come out and said like, yes, it is very short. But they did say that it was good. Like, it was, what was there was very good.
The problem isn't good or not. The problem is, does it warrant the high price?
$40.
It's $40 if you have a PS4 or Xbox One. Now, if you have a 360 or PS3, it's $30. But
and
this
digital
is
$20
and
$30. And
digital
is
$20 and $30.
Which is good for me. I'll get
$20 for the PS3 is perfect. And that's honestly what I think it should
fine,
be.
I think,
$20 and $25 digital or.
Yeah, I mean, even $20 is pushing a little bit, but this is a high quality franchise.
Right.
So it's okay.
So I get that. You know, and I'm fine with that, but $40? Like, are you fucking assholes?
No.
Like, really? Like, I'm pissed about that.
What I think is going to be able to get a lot of people to play this game, and it sounds terrible to say this in a way, but Game Informer came out and said, like, the end is, like, going to blow your mind.
Really?
Like, what the lengths that they go to, the maturity, like, the thing that happens at the end is going to make you realize that games have gone there now.
Right.
I'm going to go out there and say it's going to be something like Big Boss killing a child or something like that.
Yeah.
It's going to, or maybe it's rape, or maybe
no, it's going to be the rape scene.
Or maybe
why,
it's them going
quiet.
The part where they go into the intestines and are pulling out the bomb device. Or it could be all three. Like, but it sounds like whatever happens at the end is going to be the thing that no one's talking about right now. That is going to make a lot of people be like, all right, I got to play this. What happened? Like at the end of this, and everyone's talking about.
No, and I'm fine
about
with that. I want to see it. I want to play it. I want to get into it. I know you do. It's just the price tag feels really prohibitive for what the length.
I'm gonna feel so dirty when I buy it.
Right?
Because I'm gonna be like, I don't want to!
Like, you're gonna feel like you got raped.
Yes.
You just got raped.
Yes. By, like, George Lucas type thing.
Right,
like,
exactly.
Hideo Kojima is raping me, pretty
much. Oh my god.
Although, at the same time, this is, I feel like this is Konami.
Real quick. Kristen, noise.
What?
Alright.
That was a terrible one.
That was awful.
Sorry, I'm tired today.
What the
heck? But we've passed 100. Tonight. Thank you to everyone who's in here. Now that we've reached 100, let me say again that we are the Level Up Show. This is episode 11.
We made it past three.
We made it!
Woo!
We're now doing After Walking Dead on Sundays at 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. If you want to add us on any of these, please go ahead, especially Twitch. Hard us on Twitch so that
and
you can...
And what's not on here is Skype.
Yes.
Skype!
Which is the Level Up Show. Spell exactly how it sounds. Pretty easy. But add us on Twitter, add us on Facebook, add me and Mike on PSN. We have plenty of room.
Oh, no, you have
I have plenty of room.
I'll soon have plenty of room again.
Yeah. I'll message back and forth with you. We can play some games together. We can do some Dull and Starve streams and stuff like that and have some fun. So please add us if you haven't already.
Let's keep the stream clean.
Yeah, let's do that.
Like Dove soap.
Yes.
No bullies.
Kristen says be nice.
For the video game.
Kristen
re-released
says be
for the
nice.
Xbox 360.
But let's talk a little more about this. Kojima also said that he's not even hiding this at all. He's pretty much being very blunt on this, that it looks better on PS4 compared to Xbox One. He pretty much just flat out said that. And now on top of that, you don't really see this ever. People are like, really? Like, we want to see how much better it looks. He's like, okay, I'm putting together a video. I'll do a comparison video for you guys. He's making a comparison video to show that the PS4 version looks better. I wonder how Microsoft feels about that. Because you don't usually see that.
No.
From the developer of the game.
I feel like people in your position are going to be really happy about that because Metal Gear was a Sony franchise.
Which is why maybe he's doing this.
Right.
Maybe he still has a little bit of favoritism there.
Right. Which is
Sony.
Fine. I'm okay with that.
Thank you, Punisher.
The crow wants to adopt you.
I thought he said he wants me to adopt him.
I need a drink.
He wants you to adopt him.
No, I need like...
I'm going to get a beer anyway.
Something sugary or something.
Where do you get your sources? Like IGN?
GeoGaff
and IGN.
We literally scour everything every day.
He's all over the internet all the time.
News will literally drop on some website and one of us will message the other person immediately. And sometimes the other person, there's been times where I message him and he didn't hear anything about it and he messaged me. And it's only happened like 2 minutes before. So.
We're just obsessive. Yeah. That's pretty much the name of it.
It's not good to be obsessive about anything.
No, but I am.
Except if it's your wife.
No, then it's kind of creepy.
Or a fiance, that's different then. It's okay to be obsessive about that person.
Lemon lime's the best. I think. Of Gatorade.
I actually think the blue is better.
The Glacier Freeze, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good one too, but...
I like that one.
I've got to go with Lemon Lime. We're not advertising, by the way.
I'm sitting here waiting for you to say something about it.
By the way, guys, I wanted to tell you.
We would
be not sponsored by Gatorade.
If someone from one of the companies was watching us...
Nova Prime! I know you exist!
What?
Doug says that Kristen's training you already.
Yeah. Valentine's Day's coming up. Gotta
Nova Prime wanted us to acknowledge his or her existence, so I did.
Nova Prime, we acknowledge your existence, and we appreciate it.
Yes.
On top of that.
And
we
you
love
should,
you.
I you refuse. Should friend us somewhere.
And we appreciate your existence.
Happy that.
Add us, Nova Prime, and we will become your friend.
Did we have anything about the Olympics in our stuff? I don't think we did.
No.
Can we just for like 1 minute?
Talk about Russia.
Let's get the
depressing part of it out of the way. Fuck them for killing dogs. Let's get that out of the way.
Well, at the same, yeah. I mean, I agree, but
and then we can talk about fun stuff.
Dogs everywhere.
I don't care.
They're not necessarily rabid. They're just
they're
wild.
Strays. Yeah.
So, have you guys been watching? Did you watch the opening ceremonies and everything?
No, I actually didn't.
Oh my god, it was so entertaining. It was actually apparently the most expensive opening ceremony of any Olympics.
More than China's?
Yes.
What?
This is what was reported.
Because they developed new technology. Because the floor was based. They had a series of projectors set up to animate the floor that they were on, which looked really cool, and I have to give them props for that.
Right, and I liked it.
And then they also had the stuff going by overhead. Like, I don't know how they did that with a series of cranes. Yeah. But it's just...
It was badass.
It was really cool.
Don't get me wrong. It was pretty cool. But what's funny to me is you're spending all this money on an opening ceremony, but yet the people that are visiting there, that are Olympians, the people that are competing, you can't even build hotel rooms that are structurally sound. Yeah. Bathrooms without walls between the stalls. Yeah. There is a shower with electrical wire running through the shower.
Not only is there no wall separating... We now have to pay somebody. Damn it, Mark. They are very, very strict about the Olympic team. They really are.
We're about to get shut down because Mark had to play a joke. Way to go.
But on top of there being no dividing wall, there's a little bin where you have to throw your dirty toilet paper.
Please do not flush toilet paper and toilets. Dump in bin provided.
Which doesn't make sense to me. If crap can be flushed, why can't
it? No, it can't. There was a lot of toilets where there was no plumbing. There was no plumbing at all. You just literally in there, and then the main thing
came out.
It's essentially a built-in porta potty in the rooms.
Yeah.
But it's funny because at the Olympics, the main guy, the head, Dimitri, whatever his name is, was saying, he's like, Olympic Games are about building bridges to bring people together. Apparently, the bridges are way more important than proper plumbing and living accommodations.
Yeah, some of the tweets are amazing.
Oh, but these are mine.
There's a whole site devoted to this.
You know what's crazier? You didn't see it. The lighting of the torch was crazy. So it had this big, huge, you basically lit the torch and it was one pipe and it lit all these pipes along the way that just had gas in them and it lit along the way up to the torch and there was probably 5,000 pipes. If they had just run...
I just want to pause for a second. Nova Prime really, really wants to know what we think is the best city in the world.
I said
really
Philadelphia.
Quick, just
Philadelphia.
Are we all going to go to Philadelphia?
Philadelphia? It's always sunny in Philadelphia.
Because I haven't been to many cities.
Philadelphia has my heart. Yeah, yeah, we're from Philadelphia, so...
No, we're not.
I am. We're
from
Philadelphia.
We're from New Jersey, but we're practically Philadelphia.
I will acknowledge right off the bat that Philadelphia is not the nicest city.
No, it's not.
But it's the nicest city.
It's the nicest city.
For us, it is.
Right.
But it's kind of a shithole in the world.
Wherever home is the nicest city in the world.
I mean, obviously, New York is a nicer city than Philadelphia.
No,
are you kidding?
The nicest parts of New York are nicer.
The nicest city is probably Ontario, Canada, or something.
Or like Dallas or something. Like
somewhere,
like,
somewhere in Hawaii. Texas.
Some Canadians. No, actually, yes. I would say like maybe this is in like Norway or Sweden.
Lives there.
Okay. Would probably be the nicest.
Guys, it's okay. It's okay.
Or the Netherlands.
Let's take it easy. Nova Prime started a debate in here.
Damn it, Nova Prime!
Now continue.
Look what you did.
Sorry, but I wanted to acknowledge.
This is crazy Prime. Because like they have all these pipes running out. Why couldn't they just use some of those pipes to put into the friggin' hotels?
Yes, I know, right?
They don't have plumbing in there.
Yeah, it's embarrassing.
Yeah, Philly isn't really that nice sometimes. It can be real mean.
It's really dirty, too.
It's just home, so.
A lot of bums.
Yeah. It's just home, so that's why.
But then New York is just filled with crazy people.
Yeah.
Like Greg!
Greg! I think Now I Met Your Mother really nails that, actually, in a lot of ways.
Oh my god.
I think the skate, the guy with the roller skates wearing, like, the tights and, like, the crazy hair.
Right.
Like, I feel like the few times I've been to New York, I saw that guy.
Right?
Like, you're from How I Met Your Mother. Like, I saw you. But, yeah, so let's move on. We're
right, anyway.
Topic. So yeah, Kojima is going to make a video showing the differences between the two versions, and the PS4 version is supposedly nicer. Titanfall has been delayed, not very far.
No, it's only a few weeks.
March 25th for finishing touches.
Only for the Xbox 360, though.
Yeah.
So PC and Xbox One is still coming out on the 11th.
A little bit of worse news for some people, though, is that it won't support Steam. It's going to only support EA's Origin service.
Which makes sense.
It does, but I think people are really pissed about it.
I mean, if people are pissed about it, it means that you were just being ridiculously hopeful.
Well, people don't trust EA, they don't trust their services, so...
Origin actually hasn't been that...
No, it hasn't. No, actually it hasn't. People that have used Origin have said, like, it's not that bad, it's okay. But I just think people have a problem with EA, and...
Yeah.
So they're pretty good EA
bitch
services.
About... Well, they're just gonna bitch about anything EA does, so.
Yeah, pretty much. Well, they deserve it a little bit.
A lot of it.
Yeah. They've done some pretty bad stuff this year.
You do see some, like Origin horror stories where people are trying to talk to customer service and it's like, hey, this isn't working, what can I do? And I'm just like, sorry, I don't speak English.
I'm going to mention again real quick that we're live on Skype, the Level Up Show. Do we want to open up the phone lines?
I mean, if people are, if we open up the phone lines, are people going to call? Like, I mean, we might as well, we're not getting any calls on Skype.
Let's ask. Greg, call us.
Oh god.
We haven't got a call. Let us know if you would call us if we opened up the Google Voice number, like actual telephone number. Or if you're still going to ignore us. Let us know.
Hey, there's some nice people.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying like if they're gonna ignore the Skype capability. Right. I just wanna know because we want to talk to people.
Yeah.
And people are complaining about us not talking to them.
Right.
And we're trying. We want to talk to you.
We only get two lines of comments right in front of us. We can't see everything. So sometimes five comments will fly
by.
That's
why we're here.
Yeah.
Right.
Kristen and Mark help with us. There you go.
Call in there.
Please Skype call us, man.
Yes.
Or woman.
Please. Person.
Person.
Okay.
Greg.
Hi, party people.
Hi.
Hey, man. How you doing?
I'm repping Disney.
Oh, nice.
My constellation happened there. I would not be here today if it wasn't for Disney.
Yeah, Greg was conceived in Disney World.
Yes. To give some personal information on Greg, he was conceived in Disney. Greg, thank you again. You are our first caller. See, guys?
I don't know why people don't call you guys. Most people are saying they're shy, but like...
Hey, Sam.
This is what you can do. You can call us. You don't have to do video either. Actually, we kind of prefer you
don't. Greg, can you see me?
I can't see you.
Why?
I'll be looking more quick. I can see you like through the stream thing, but I can't see you through Skype.
Why?
Because I disabled it, I think.
Oh no!
I don't want to clog up our bandwidth and all that kind of stuff. Fleecy's calling us too. Fleecy, call back in like 5 minutes or something after Greg's done. Fleecy will call back.
Greg,
sure.
You're ruining people's lives.
Mike, you never answered me back.
What? With what?
About you were like, oh, will you be my Valentine? I was like, yes. And I said, aren't we going to be in love forever? And nothing happened.
Oh, I didn't see you. See, that's what I'm talking about.
It's
these
fine.
Things fly by, and I don't see them. Like, the only thing I saw was you asking Mark to feed you sushi by hand.
Oh, yeah, that got awkward. I didn't know. out there. But I don't judge. As long as Mark's feeding somebody, I guess. Right?
Oh, that's
funny.
Whoa. Me. Greg, I want to thank you for demonstrating Skype. As a capability.
This is how Skype works.
This is what you can do.
This is what happens when you Skype us. Skype
I don't know why us. I'm making robot motions as you guys are.
Alright, so I'm gonna shut you down for a second.
Wait, I want him to say, it's my best friend's a Level Up Show.
Yeah, he didn't give us. That's like your theme song, dude. What the hell?
Go ahead.
It's the Level Up Show, and I'm chilling with my best friends, yeah.
You can just change it every week.
It's a different variation every time.
He'll change it every week.
Every week, I'll be the same until I freaking become blue and I can use magical music editing power.
Wow. How are you enjoying your $4,000, you lucky bitch?
It all went in the bank. Most of it's going to college, and nice. I put some of it aside to go probably concert somewhere. I'm assuming maybe Philly.
Don't tell too many people that you have $4,000 to.
Mike?
Probably not the best idea.
He mentioned it to 140 people last week.
I'm kidding. I don't care. People don't know where I live.
Right. It's not like they have his bank account.
Why don't you tell him where you live? He lives now too, Mike. Go ahead. Tell
him.
Well, he lives at 145. No, I'm kidding.
He's from New York. Let's just say that, right?
Why are we telling them all this information?
I need to be more specific. Go into the Yellow Pages and find Greg Virgo.
He's putting himself out there. All right, Greg, thank you so much.
God bless. Love you all.
See you, man.
Love you, Gregory. Spit726, I've been messaging you. This is a gaming podcast. We discuss current games.
You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to call Fleecy. I'm going to call her back, or him back.
Person. This is what we should do. We should have a segment where we just call a random one of our old viewers.
Fleecy, I'm calling you right now.
Hello.
Hey, how you doing?
Not too bad. How are you?
Doing great. Welcome to the Level Up Show. We decided to call you back since we hung up on you.
Oh, no, that's okay.
All right, cool.
At 10:47 p.m. my time, EricChan76 said, Nintendo CEO needs to be tossed and Mario needs to be on PS4. I disagree with that, but I want to hear what you guys have to say about that.
You might disagree with me a little bit too then. I do agree that Iwata is making some terrible decisions here and there.
Yeah.
He's trying to get into mobile devices now, it sounds like.
Yeah.
And that might be just the start of this whole thing. It might be that it's moving towards PS4 and Xbox One eventually. I think this is kind of testing the waters, maybe.
Wait, did she say that Microsoft CEO needs to get
No, she's talking about Nintendo CEO, I think. Okay. Right? Oh, you said Nintendo CEO, Iwata, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Go ahead. Well, how do you feel about the possibility?
So here's the thing. I don't mind, actually, that he's going to mobile. I think that's actually a smarter move for them.
Yeah.
If they do it the right way. I think releasing their old catalog of games, like from, you know, NES and Super NES, so that people don't have to worry about relying on emulators to steal the games from them, I think is a much better move because they'll probably support it in a beneficial way, but they honestly need to do more than just that. I think that's just, you know, baby steps, and I think he's really not doing a very good job of taking damage control.
Fleecy, the way I feel about it is, what benefit do we really receive from Nintendo making hardware? They're sometimes innovative, I'll say that.
Yeah.
But really, like, the Wii was innovative, but also became a dud, really. The technology wasn't used in very compelling ways, ever, in my opinion. The Wii U with its pad is just kind of a dud as well, because it didn't really kind of foresee the trends in America the way they should have. So with them being graphically inferior and whatnot as well, what's the benefit of Nintendo making hardware?
I don't know.
Chirp, chirp. This is not a rhetorical question.
I didn't know if you wanted me to respond to that.
No, I'm sorry. Yeah, Drew's long-winded, so he just talks, so you never really know what he's actually done.
Like I said, I thought, you know, that statement was, to me, it was a little bit out of its shell.
Okay.
And I wanted to hear what you guys had to say about it.
Yeah, I don't think he needs to get...
I mean, for me, it's more of the nostalgia factor, you know? I've grown up with Mario, and he's always been on Nintendo.
Yeah, right.
I don't know, it would kind of break my heart seeing him go to PlayStation.
I completely agree with that, and I think that would... And that's where I don't agree with, like... releasing their IPs to PS4 and Xbox.
Well, that's why I think they won't do it. They have a lot of pride.
Right, they have a lot of pride, and that's fine, but they really need to expand. I think, honestly, in my opinion, what they really need to do is ditch the whole home console idea or make, like, a really cheap version of, you know, classics that they, you know, one easy machine that's not gimmicky, that doesn't have this crazy new innovation that no one understands.
Yeah.
You know, so that they can play, you know, make it really accessible to play old school games as well as new current IPs for Mario, Zelda, their main ones, you know, Samus, everything like that. But stop, you know, relying on that as your sole thing. The 3DS is doing phenomenal because it's appealing to the right audience, but they have not hit their audience with the...
Fleecy, let me ask you one more thing real quick.
Sure thing.
So imagine that it did come to PS4. Let's say Mario came to PS4, and you boot it up, and you see the classic Nintendo symbol rotating with, you know, Nintendo, like music and whatnot, Mario music. How would that make you feel? Like, would that really bother you to see the Nintendo logo in front of Mario on a PlayStation console?
Like, if they kept it exactly the same, you know, the, like, the same Mario feel on like, a PlayStation, I think even still I would kind of,
like,
feel out of place playing it.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I agree. I mean,
I can't blame that at all.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be pretty cool seeing Nintendo as a third-party developer, almost, in a way.
Yeah.
But you gotta remember, look at Sega and Sonic.
Yeah. Well, Sega and Sonic were already kind of in a, I feel like, going downhill.
No,
but
I mean, Sonic on the Sonic on his last adventure, Sonic Adventure for the Dreamcast, was great.
Pretty, yeah.
That was great. It was a really good game. And then after that, once they went to third-party development, and that was it, it just was shit.
See, like, what, the reason we're still going on about this, we probably should stop.
Yeah.
But it does give me a little bit of excitement at the same time, though, because hopefully they would keep all their same teams, would still be all the same Nintendo-quality developers, except they would have the power of a PS4 and Xbox One. Pretty much, they don't have to put any work into the hardware anymore. They can just devote themselves entirely to software, which is what makes Nintendo special in the first place, and then have this great hardware behind it. But I completely understand what you're saying, Lisey. Thanks so much for calling.
Yeah, no problem. I just wanted to add to it, too, that I played a lot of Final Fantasy games, too, when I was a kid, especially on Nintendo and SNES. And I mean, when I first played FF7 on the PlayStation, I kind of felt how maybe I would feel if...
I know.
Mario went to PlayStation.
But then at the same time,
you know,
PlayStation.
But I kind of got used to it.
Yeah, you did get used to it, but I completely understand that. At the time, that was a very big deal when Final Fantasy VI was on Super Nintendo and was probably one of the best Final Fantasies ever made. Right. And then Final Fantasy VII, which is also, I got to say, one of the best, came to PlayStation. Yeah, it hurt a lot of people. So I completely understand. Thanks for calling again.
Yeah, no problem. Thanks.
See ya. That was a great call. That was awesome.
That's actually like one of the best calls we've ever gotten, just because it posed a question that was related to something someone else.
I'm going
to
call Jason Gonzalez back, because he tried to call twice. Hopefully you pick up, Jason.
Jason!
Is he a Celtics fan?
No.
I don't think so.
I don't think so.
Hey, Jason, you're live on the Level Up Show.
What's up?
Hey, sorry that we missed your call. We were talking to Fleecy.
Okay.
What do you want to talk about, man?
Okay, I want to talk about Sledgehammer, mostly.
We were going to talk about that later. We'll talk about it now for you.
We'll bring it up a little bit, yeah.
So I'm guessing you want to talk about them being the third part of the development teams.
Which we knew about for a while.
On Call of Duty, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, so if anyone doesn't know, we'll just kind of put the information
out
there.
Why don't you actually go into the news topic a little bit? Well,
that's exactly what I'm going to do. I think a lot of people know that it's been alternating year on year between Treyarch and Infinity Ward.
Right.
And Treyarch has really, really taken a hold of that series, in my opinion, done really cool things with it.
I liked Infinity Ward better.
I think people liked Infinity Ward, and now they're starting to like Treyarch more,
in my opinion. Yeah,
I think people are starting to...
Anyway, everyone has their favorite.
Sledgehammer, isn't the beginning for them.
Right.
Sledgehammer had a part in Modern Warfare 3.
We actually, when Sledgehammer was first announced, we actually thought that they were making their own more adventure game style Call of Duty. I was like, what, 4 years ago now? So
now we receive news that instead of a 2-year development cycle, Call of Duty is now moving towards a 3-year development cycle, which is awesome. And they're going to have 3 different developers on it: Infinity Ward, Treyarch, and now Sledgehammer, with, it sounds like, a good portion of people from the Dead Space series being a part of it, which is also pretty cool. So in my opinion, I think this is great. I think there's nothing to complain about here.
Right.
You got another developer, a promising developer, getting 3 years instead of 2 on a series that is getting a little bit stale.
Right. But, well, I mean, did you have any question about Sledgehammer itself in particular, or?
Sorry, Jason, do you hear us?
Yeah.
We were asking if there was a, well, how do you feel about Sledgehammer in general?
The only problem is that we need to wait another year for zombies. Yeah, I do like zombies a lot.
Okay, so that's actually what I was going to bring up. Is we've gotten very used to this whole thing, like Modern Warfare started it. Yeah, well, actually the original Call of Duty started. It was Call of Duty 1, 2, 3. Yeah. Then you went into Modern Warfare. So then it was Modern Warfare, and then World at War, and then Black Ops. So it went back and forth, but you were able to build a trilogy with Modern Warfare. And it looks like they were trying to build a trilogy with Black Ops 2. So, you know, it's very confusing, and I don't really know what's going to happen. Are they going to try to continue a story, you know, and wait 3 years to continue it? Do they really feel like they have, you know, that much regret? Like, for most people, the Call of Duty game, when you play it, you mostly get it for the multiplayer and play the story a little bit. Yeah, you play the story, it's great, but you mostly rely on the multiplayer. Do they really feel that they have enough of a hold you know, to rely on people waiting 3 years to continue that story and then another 3 years to finish it.
And on top of that, Jason's fearful of having to wait a really long time for zombies. But let's give Sledgehammer a little bit of credit here. They might do something just as interesting. Mm-hmm. Because we got aliens now as the thing, right?
Right.
With this new Call of Duty. So zombies will come back, aliens will come back potentially.
Vampires!
It might sound stupid, but Sledgehammer might come up with their own quirky little idea to be the thing that... Are you okay?
That was hard.
She hit herself on the thing there.
Sorry, Jason.
But yeah, I mean, stay hopeful. I would stay hopeful because, yeah, you might have to wait 3 years for zombies, but there might be something really cool in between to fill in that gap for you.
All right,
man. Thanks for calling.
Oh, yeah. One more.
Oh, yeah. Sure. Go ahead.
I want to know what they put. When is the next PS4 update for the suspend resume and the... where you control other people's using the, do you know when you control people's gameplay?
This is something they showed off in the February reveal, something a lot of people are excited about. The unfortunate thing is they said that it wasn't going to be there at launch. Yeah. And on top of that, the suspend resume was supposed to be there at launch, and they said we're going to have to push that back a little bit.
Which, if it's not working, I'm okay with that.
Make it work.
Yeah,
but
make it work.
Hopefully it's soon. Unfortunately, there isn't any confirmed date or anything for that. I'm hoping that maybe February 22nd could be a big deal. That's the big Japan launch.
Right.
I'm sure they want to have something to show off at launch for that. So maybe there will be a software update coinciding with that, and maybe we'll get some of these.
Or an announcement at least of something.
Maybe. Yeah, so right now, Jason, there's no... confirmed solid news on date, but hopefully it's sometime soon.
Okay.
All right.
Cool. Thanks, man. Thanks for calling.
See you later. All right. So there you go. This is what you guys can do. You can call on Skype, and we can have some good conversation.
All right, why don't we continue on to another story since we
This is another really interesting story. I'm skipping ahead. No multiplayer in the Order 1886.
I'm okay with it.
Don't care.
Yeah, I'm
happy with it.
I'm really getting tired. I've even said this multiple times. Yeah. I'm getting so tired with this tacked-on multiplayer.
Yeah, definitely. Especially for something at launch where they don't have a lot of time. They're clearly focusing on a single-player narrative, linear-based game, really pushing a cinematic experience. They're doing the 1920 by 860, instead of 1080, to give it that filmic feel with the bars on the top and bottom.
Right.
They're doing a lot of stuff to really give it that cinematic feel, so clearly that's what they're going for. They're not going for a buddy multiplayer game here.
I'm great with this.
Although it might have co-op.
Yeah, and that would be great. I mean, they don't want to put that tacked on multiplayer.
Yeah, they don't want to waste their resources, and I completely understand that. Give us the best single player experience we can possibly get,
because
that's clearly what you're focusing on. Great news there for me. Oh, and one more on top of that. They said that they're using 4x MSAA. If you don't know what that is, that's really high quality anti-aliasing, and they're using 4x it.
That's
high quality.
Crazy.
Supposedly this game looks amazing.
Yeah, the detail on this is going to be phenomenal. Yeah.
And one of the reasons they can do that is because of the 1920x800. Because they're getting rid of so many lines of horizontal resolution, it allows them to push that towards other areas.
And I'm fine with that.
So a lot of people are saying maybe you should give the option for 1920x1080 and then maybe lower the anti-aliasing.
I think you're going to enjoy it all the same.
Zenus brought.
Awesome. Okay, moving on, because we have a lot to discuss, and we want to get done this by midnight, hopefully. Flappy Bird.
This is awesome. All right, so
let's talk about Flappy Bird. Flappy Bird, the game, has been around for a really long time, but it didn't take off like it has until the last month or so, right?
Yeah, I didn't actually know it was around that long.
It's been around for a while,
I didn't know that.
And suddenly it came to the front of the... App Store in front of Angry Birds and everything else. It was getting millions of downloads a day, and supposedly the guy
$50,000 a day or something.
$50,000 a day in ad revenue.
Yeah,
this guy did not put a lot of work into this game.
Basically,
never expected.
I bless you if you have no idea what Flappy Bird is. You are a lucky fucking.
I actually feel sad that we're telling you what it is.
Right. I don't. I mean, I have to.
But you might not be able to play it anyway because supposedly you took it down.
Well, if you still have it. Are you playing it right now?
I'm going to
play it right now.
Alright, so I'm going to talk to you guys while they play Flappy Bird.
Let's play Flappy Bird.
Flappy Bird is a very simplistic game where you tap on the screen and it raises up a bird and you have to go through pipes that look very reminiscent of Super Mario pipes. So here's the issue here. This guy's making $50,000 a day in ad revenue off a game where it seems like all the assets were stolen from other games, from the coin sound to the pipes to even Flappy Bird himself seeming like a merge of two different Super Mario creatures. So, the guy is getting a lot of flack, and because of that, he feels like the game has ruined his life. He actually came out and said, let's see here. I can call Flappy Bird is a success of mine, but it also ruins my simple life, so now I hate it. And then, a little bit later on in that day, he came out and said, guys, I'm sorry, but I'm removing Flappy Bird from the App Store. I am rejecting the $50,000 a day in ad revenue that I am currently receiving, because I guess he doesn't like the...
I think he's just getting annoyed that people have shed him in such a negative light.
Not only that, but everyone's asking for patches, because I don't know about you, but I get bugs in that game all the time.
When you don't hit a pipe and it says you hit a pipe?
Well, more so when Flappy Bird doesn't appear. Have you ever had that?
I've never had that.
Where he's just invisible?
I also didn't play it enough as you to get to level 84.
I got
84?
I got 84 or something like that, yeah. That's my high score.
See?
I didn't play it that long. I'm going to say right now, I have not played Flappy Bird that long. But I did get an 84 high score. What's your high score in Flappy Bird?
I don't even want to
know. I'd like to know if anyone has like a really crazy high score.
Greg is like one of the people out there that I think has.
It might be still in the App Store. If you want to experience the frustration that is Flappy Bird, get it right now before he takes it down. Give him a little bit more money before he turns it all away. It's already gone.
From what I know, okay. From what I understand, it's already gone. So.
Well, watch videos then. But it's really one of those it's a phenomenon, really, kind of in a way.
I hate it. I love it. And what's funny is you actually downloaded it last week when we were watching the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
Saying this is stupid, and then you couldn't stop playing it.
I wouldn't say that. I probably put maybe like 30 minutes into it, which is all you really need to put into it.
But that's a really long time, and you didn't
138.
Stop.
Someone had 138, and Doug says it's down. 6. I think you probably stopped pretty soon. But yeah, there's a lot of people that just
22,
can't
and I was like,
figure it no. out, kind of. They can't figure out the rise.
What? Get out of here.
Drop.
No way.
Ghost, are you serious right now?
I can't see 1028.
Yeah.
I can't see that.
I can't.
I don't even know it goes that far.
Well, on top of that, like another thing that he hasn't patched in yet is that you can't get above 9,999.
Really?
So, like the top list, like the top people in the world, is this just enormous list of people having 9,999. It's like, that's like a big flaw to the game.
But how do you get that far?
I know. I mean, really, yeah.
You can't pause this game.
Yeah. No, you can. You can pause it, actually. There's a little pause button, I think, in the upper left, which would be very difficult to resume.
Right.
But, let's take, for instance, that it takes 2 or 3 seconds to go through a
pipe. All right, Ghost said he's kidding.
Okay, thank God.
All right.
If it takes you 2 to 3 seconds to go through a pipe, that's 30,000 seconds, which is, like, divided by 60, that's got to be 500? Or something, 500 minutes of straight Flappy Bird play?
Oh, my God.
That's a lot of minutes of straight Flappy Bird play.
Oh, my God.
So, yeah.
That's what I'm assuming.
Yeah, see, that's the... Exactly. Is there a hack for it? If there is, that makes more sense.
Then that makes much more sense. That's what I was assuming.
But still, that's still... Okay, it's a hack score. So maybe he needs to patch that in. But I think that was the problem, is people were demanding patches. He's one guy who made a game 7 months ago that he never expected to take off.
He just wanted to do it.
Yeah, he's just doing a little...
He's probably honestly just one of those guys, he made this game just, I want to see what I can do, I want to see if anybody would download it. And everybody's getting on his case like, oh, it has no original artwork, and it's it's like, dude, I just wanted to do something.
He didn't expect
this. Right, he probably did it in like, what, maybe like 4 weeks?
Give him a break. Although, I can't really sympathize that much with the guy. He made how much money, how fast?
But I don't think he's keeping anything.
I think he'll keep what he got. He's just rejecting any further, profit that he makes. All right. We already talked about this. Call of Duty is now in a 3-year development cycle.
Yep.
And Rocksteady Studios getting ready to announce something big. They were inviting journalists to a big press event.
Right.
No one's allowed to talk about right now.
Which is weird, because I honestly thought that they said they were done with the Batman series.
No, the rumor was that they were going to do a Silver Age thing, and it was going to start incorporating other characters in the DC universe, such as Superman. Even.
All right, because maybe they just said that they were done with the whole Arkham series. Maybe that's what they said.
Yeah.
So I'm okay with that.
We're going to talk about Dark Souls a little later, because our topic of the week is difficulty versus accessibility. So that really fits in with that topic.
That's like the complete opposite of the games.
It sounds like there's a 1-month embargo currently on this, which. Could be a hint that it might be a Game Informer cover.
Yeah.
It might be next month's Game Informer cover. It has to be the Batman game. I mean, it fits. Right. Maybe they want to get it out by the end of this year. This would be a nice time to announce
October,
it.
October, probably. Yeah,
I hope even though Origins is not at all a bad game, I think people gave
it
a lot of flack.
It's not a bad game, but there's a lot of... You can see the issues because it wasn't the traditional Rocksteady, you know, Batman Arkham game.
Hopefully they switch this up. I think Silver Age would be pretty cool. Incorporate Superman, because we've been waiting forever for a good Superman game.
Dude, Superman 64 was a shit.
Yeah. You know what? It's funny, because I played Superman 64 at launch. I rented it from Blockbuster. I didn't think it was bad at the time, but maybe I was too young.
Have you looked at it?
Like the fog and stuff. It's just like, obviously, they're covering up all the terrible graphics in the game. Is it that bad? I don't know. Maybe it is.
Right.
Okay, so look forward to Rocksteady's announcement probably next month. Why don't you talk about this one, because I have no idea what it's about, but Rust.
Okay, so Rust, this was actually pretty interesting.
I've seen some of that.
Yeah, well, have you seen, so do you know what it was about?
Not
Rust
really,
is essentially similar to DayZ, but they added the ability to build forts and everything like that, fortify and everything, but it has the same aspect that DayZ has, where it's, you know, human interaction as well. Well, they've been doing a bunch of updates and everything like that, and the newest update actually was one that fans were, you know, or some fans were clamoring for.
Hey, Matt, how you doing, man?
Hey, guys.
Hey.
Hey, what do you want to talk about this week?
I actually have a lot to talk about from what I heard last week.
Okay, go ahead.
So far, the first thing I want to talk about is the new Sonic Boom that Sega had announced.
Okay.
I mean,
I saw just a little bit about this. To be honest with you, I don't know too much. I saw some video of it.
I have three stories that I have.
When I first saw that trailer of the game, I mean, I was just surprised that Sega would even bother redesigning Sonic from what it used to be. I mean, they basically just stretch them out. Like, Sonic Tails and Amy and Knuckles are just all stretched out, wrapped in bandages. And Knuckles is taller than the three of them. I mean, it's just amazing. I mean, how they managed to do something like that. I mean, and not only that, I don't know how it's gonna do the game, you know?
Yeah, I mean, Sonic, what was the last Sonic? Do you guys, anyone remember what the last Sonic was?
It was a Wii game. It was Sonic Generations?
Yeah, I feel like, and I heard it was decent.
It was pretty good. Oh no, Sonic Lost World. And it was awful.
And it was terrible. Okay.
It was like trying to be like Mario Galaxy.
Yeah. Yeah, you know what, they're hit or miss. And we kind of talked about earlier about the possibility of Nintendo going third party and the fear of them becoming like Sega and how they were with Sonic. So I think there's, you just gotta play by ear with it with Sonic. It's just sometimes they hit, sometimes they miss.
Mm-hmm.
So right now I can't speak too much about this new Sonic Boom. Terrible name.
I'll talk about it. If we have
do you have something you want to say about Sonic?
No, I mean, it's just it's interesting. So they're trying to basically reimagine Sonic.
Yeah.
So if you look at that, you've seen the images. You said,
I've seen the images.
Yeah. People are bitching because they gave him the Nathan Drake scarf.
Yeah.
You know, and they made Knuckles twice the size of everybody.
Yeah.
One big design flaw is Tails is right at Knuckles' like area, like it's perfectly in line.
Okay.
So he's that short, but they're gonna be doing, I think they said, a TV show, the game, and I think even a comic. For it. So, you know, it could be interesting, you know, it could be perfectly fine, you know, but everybody bitches about everything. It is kind of weird that they're making him pretty puny. Like, if you look at the original Sonic, he was kind of beefy, whereas now he's like, you know, an angsty teenager look, you know, so.
Yeah.
Celtics fan thinks Walking Dead was awesome tonight. I thought it was
okay. I'm going to disagree.
Yeah. I think it was okay, Jason. I was a little disappointed with some of the acting from Carl and the Michonne scene, and just that it focused on three characters and the whole episode. Got a little boring, in my opinion. Sorry, Matt, go ahead.
I heard about the TV show stuff, and I don't know what channel's going to be on.
Disney.
Probably on
Cartoon Network
cartoon
or something.
Yeah. Show, so.
Thank you for the friend request.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you have any other stories, Matt, that you want to get to real quick? Because we're running long already, to be honest with you.
And not only that, I also want to bring up that Microsoft had board of directors had chosen a new CEO.
Yeah,
we actually
talked about that earlier, Matt. His name is Satya Nadella. And he had a lot to do with the cloud services over at Microsoft, and I think it was a good choice. I think, especially over ELOP.
Yeah.
We were talking about how ELOP was rumored to have some things against Xbox and Bing and Surface. So I think it's a great choice, actually. I hope that it kind of writes some of the directions they were heading in, and let's see what happens, I guess, right?
Yeah, I think I'm okay with that.
Yeah, definitely. Thanks so much for calling, Matt.
All right.
Thank you, Matt. Right.
See you, Matt.
You're welcome. Six times, right?
Woo! Woo!
Bye. Yeah.
Gonna keep score for you, Matt, soon.
Alright, so basically, anyway, the Rust.
Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
No, that's fine. Rust, it was basically a zombie survival. You could build forts, you could build, build stuff with it. You know, it was pretty cool. So it was like DayZ Plus.
Yeah.
That's why a lot of people liked it. But some of the people were clamoring that it was too difficult, to do it with some of the mechanics in it. So one of the things that they took out was zombies. So it started as a zombie survival game, and now they took out the zombies, which is pretty cool because now it's going towards basically a world survival, like a post-apocalyptic survival, where you have to build your own.
Just kind of like the road or something. Just kinda like something.
Imagine DayZ meets the road meets Minecraft.
Yeah.
So it's actually pretty interesting. So I was actually leaning more towards playing this than I was towards playing DayZ.
Okay.
But now I'm probably gonna definitely get this.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah. So I'm gonna probably get both.
Someone's asking what happened to the Sparta show. I actually don't know what happened to the Sparta show. I haven't seen them on in a while.
His wife probably had a kid. She was pregnant.
Yeah, that's true. His wife was pregnant.
His wife was pregnant, so he could have had the baby.
He had a lot going on, I think, already. And, he was doing the show so often, I think people kind of started to expect that. And then it got a little too much for him. He started dialing back.
Right, well, he cut it back because he was realizing that it was too much.
Yeah.
And then I think people were getting annoyed, and then he wasn't actually getting that many viewers. But every time we looked in, he was only at, 30.
Yeah.
So.
And I know he got sick around the new year. So he might come back. Maybe he had his kid and he's just refreshing or something and getting ready to do some cool things. He might be come back.
Thank you for calling, Fleecy. Thank you.
That was a great call.
That was great.
Yeah, thank you very much.
So anyway, we have that. And there was something else that someone said that I wanted to talk about. Oh, you didn't have this in your news either. Did you see the comparison for Elder Scrolls Online?
I saw IGN's, I saw their comparison between the lowest quality and the highest quality.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Okay, yeah, I did see that.
That is alarming.
Yes, it is. It's a big difference.
That's a huge difference. So if anybody hasn't seen this, Elder Scrolls Online is coming out in the next couple months.
Yeah.
And
Ghost is playing it. He's in the beta.
Yeah, and I would be in the beta right now if I had my computer. Where actually, I probably could run it on my computer.
Maybe at low quality. Yeah.
Yeah.
Ghost really likes the Safari. He's impressed.
Yeah, I'm actually really excited to play it. So, but they did a comparison of highest quality, which is going to be great. It's going to show all the detail possible. And then they had the lowest quality, which usually is there's a big difference. Yeah. But this was an alarming. This was literally comparing a PS4 game to an Xbox original game.
Yeah, pretty much.
Like it was bad.
Yeah, but the thing is, if this is just getting people the capability to play it on a really terrible computer, also.
Right? And that's great if if it lets me play it on the piece of crap that I have right now.
Yeah, but if you still need a decent setup in order to play lowest quality, that's bad.
Right.
No, but I don't know, to be honest with you, what the requirements are for any of those settings.
I don't remember right now.
It is a very large difference, though.
Yeah, but it's huge. It's alarming.
It looks good on high quality, though.
It looks great on high quality. Yeah, it looks
especially
like
Skyrim. Especially the character development.
Oh my god, it's phenomenal. Yeah.
In comparison to Skyrim, even, the character development.
Right. That's what it says, Skyrim Plus.
Yeah, definitely. I agree. So. This is good news for guys like us. Twitch streaming announced that they had the fourth highest peak traffic share for the week ending February 3rd. It had higher traffic than Facebook and Amazon.
Which is not surprising. Do you know what's going on right now? The League of Legends tournaments.
Okay, that might be
why.
What's that?
League of Legends?
It's a very big game.
It's a really big game. It's huge, and it's been going on, and Peter, my buddy, he was pissed off because he missed one of the games while he was at work, and one guy today was mad because he missed one of the matches.
See you, Shadow Sergeant. Thanks for watching.
Thank you.
And to Super Sosa, we are very excited about Infamous Second Son. I think that's probably going to be when you pick up your PS4, actually.
Yeah, I might pull the trigger and get it closer.
Okay.
I'm dying for it. I want to get it.
But that game looks amazing. I'm happy that there's no multiplayer in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
They're devoting everything towards their single player story. I think it's gonna be awesome. I think it's gonna be Infamous 2 on steroids. I think I think it's gonna have a lot of cool powers, and I like the idea of sucking powers out of other supers and stuff like that. It's gonna be cool for sure. I hope it's I hope it's lengthy, 15 hours or so.
Right.
At least it gets multiple playthroughs, hopefully.
Mike party chat all night every way. You know what sucks, Greg, is I've been missing out on playing with people. My internet's being really screwed. I haven't been able to get online with my PlayStation. so I haven't been able to do like party chats or playthroughs with anybody, and it sucks because I don't know if you know this, Craig. I've been waiting to play Borderlands so I get back on again with you. So I'm holding out for you, but we'll party chat when I get it.
Team Ninja is developing a PlayStation 4 game, maybe exclusively. Mm-hmm. They came out and said, we are developing a PS4 game internally. They didn't say anything about any other platforms.
Right.
Which kind of implies that it's going to be exclusive. Which probably means it's not Dead or Alive. Or something like that. That would probably be a multi-platform game. Probably won't be a Ninja game. That would probably be multi-platform. Yeah. So maybe they got a new IP
which
coming.
Would be great.
That would be awesome, yeah. I'm not the biggest Team Ninja fan, I'll be honest with you. Now I'm not.
I thought you liked, what was the one that they did? I thought you liked the...
You might be thinking of Ninja Theory.
Shout out to the crowd.
Are you thinking of like Heavenly Sword and Ninja Theory?
Yeah, okay.
Which a lot of people are getting confused about. I would have been really happy if that was the case. They also did Devil May Cry, Ninja Theory, which you I think might be playing, right? I think that's all.
Yeah. So I'm gonna,
we're gonna get to that very soon. We're almost done
soon because
we're almost done the news stories.
Time on the news today.
Yeah. Shuhei Yoshida was hinting at some unknown internal development games.
Yeah.
So, there's four here. There's Sony Bend, Sony Santa Monica, Guerrilla Games, and Media Molecule. And he kind of had one word to say about each. I'll save the most interesting for last. So, Sony Santa Monica, he said, scary. I think this is a space game. This is what the rumors are, that it's a space game. Scary can mean a lot of things. I don't know, but I don't...
Dead Space clone.
I actually don't think it'll be survival horror.
No.
I don't think that's what he means by scary. I think Sony Santa Monica is going in a different direction. The last one I think is going to do scary. I'll say that in a second. Guerrilla Games, he says epic. A lot of people are rumoring Western RPG style game for them.
Which awesome. They need. We need badly right now.
And it fits in perfectly with epic, I think. Media Molecule, extraordinary. Which makes perfect sense.
Again, you know, innovative is probably another word he probably could have used.
They're probably doing something very, very creative. I don't think anyone has any idea, though, what they're doing right now. It's going to be something that I think no one saw coming.
Was it Megan? It's something. What?
What?
What was the name on there for person Megan? That one. Who's that?
Meeg Nistadwort.
I know.
Xbox One, PS4, worst launch ever. No games.
One of the stronger launches
of any console
in a long time.
Some delays at the beginning.
There are some delays, but I think we had 12 games that launched for both systems, and I think the most games that launched for any other system was like 8.
Yeah, so, maybe like the first party offerings weren't that mind-blowing, but you can't just keep those in mind. You got taken in the Assassin's Creed and the Call of Duty and the Battlefield, but like taking all those games and taking the indie games too, taking Resogun, taking Don't Starve, taking Knack, which was surprisingly good. I know it got
Forza,
terrible reviews.
Rise, you had Dead Rising.
Yeah,
you know, it's not our fault.
Now we have Outlast.
Through 12 games within 2 months, 12 games is a long time.
Yeah.
I play, 2 games a month maybe, if we're lucky?
Yeah, I mean, if you got a lot more time than me, then maybe it's been a little lackluster,
but
I've got plenty to play.
Right, I've got a lot to play.
Killzone, I'm going to talk about that in a little bit, because that's starting to surprise me a little bit. Last but not least, Sony Bend, who are more well-known for their portable games, Shuhei Yoshida had this to say, panic. Now, that's the most interesting for me, I think. That's, to me, implies survival horror. Panic. Now
or music, so it could be at the disco.
That was terrible.
Sorry.
I am Sam. Message Andrew at DreamsMD.
Yeah.
Just message me or add me, please, too.
Yeah.
Let me say again, please, heart us on Twitch so you get notifications when we go live. Follow us on Twitter for all of our schedule updates and whatnot. Facebook, and at the bottom, those are myself and Mike's PSN IDs. Please add us, friend us, and we'll talk. We'll message with you. We'll play games.
Did you put anything in there about the Division collaboration?
No, not yet.
Okay.
You can talk about that at the very end. Also, we're still open on Skype if you want to call us. Mm-hmm. We're the Level Up Show on Skype. If you want to put that in there real quick, Mark.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the most interesting. I would like to have a Sony exclusive survival horror series.
Yeah,
I feel like that's kind of what I'm seeing here. Is you got space game, you got RPG, you've got maybe survival horror. Maybe Sony's really kind of trying to get every single genre tackled with their internal development studios, which is really smart. I hope that's what they're doing.
Right. No, I completely agree.
The Last of Us leads thinking up ideas for The Last of Us 2 or a new IP. I'm going to read this quote off here. We have started brainstorming some stuff. To be honest, some of them are sequel ideas and some of them are brand new IP. We've spent the last few weeks brainstorming new IP, so we have to get some good steps and see. It's kind of like how we approached Left Behind. Can we tell people a story that's really worth telling and that's not repeating itself? If we can't, where can we get inspired? What is something that's really going to challenge us and push storytelling in this medium forward? I completely agree. If you can't tell an interesting story on the level of The Last of Us, then don't do a sequel.
I want them to do a new IP.
Yeah, I do too.
I think Last of Us was done. Yeah. I think it would be interesting if we got DLC in the form of, like, you know, his brother, you know, and stuff like that. Or Ish. I mean, again, everybody in the one thing was brought up, we already know what happens to Ish.
Pretty much,
we know the whole thing.
Not after he leaves the store, but
we know, well, we know pretty much what happens.
He gets out.
Right. But again, it's one of those things where, you know, DLC would be fine for Last of Us, but I'm done. I don't want any more. I don't know what they could do. If they did prequel to The Last of Us, I'd hate it. Yeah. If they did a post Last of Us, it wouldn't be as good as The Last of Us was. It's just,
yeah, it's like it's hard for me to imagine them reaching that quality level.
Nope.
Of course, the graphics will be better and whatnot, but the story in The Last of Us was a one-time deal. You can't retell that story; it's already been done.
It's like making a sequel to Shawshank Redemption.
Yeah, yeah.
What do you do from that?
Yeah,
like it's two characters and it's an interesting story.
Danny Dufresne keeping his cover.
Right, right. Like, what do you do with that?
With his pleasant friend on the beach. I'd watch it, but
yeah, wouldn't be very good.
If they don't have a better story to tell, then they probably shouldn't.
Yeah, I'm good with that. I'm fine with that.
So finally, we are done with the topics for the week, stories. We'll take a few seconds while we're doing what you've been playing and let people call, possibly, if they want to. Once again, the Skype is the Level Up Show, and if you want to talk about any of the stories we previously discussed, please do so. I'll leave that open.
Right.
And let me make sure. Yep, it's good. We're good to go.
Here, Super Sosa, I know. I do see your question. Super Sosa.
What does Super Sosa
keeps asking about Dragon Ball Z? But I just want to say that I had told him to message you, but he keeps asking. So.
Just message me on my name, Super Sosa, and we'll talk.
Apparently, the new Dragon Ball Z game. I didn't play it, but I don't know if you're friends with Sean at all.
No.
He played the crap out of it, from what I see.
Okay.
Every 5 minutes, he's getting a goddamn new trophy. So he's into it, but from what I'm hearing, it's good. You know, the graphics are improved, everything like that, but the new mechanics that they added are great in idea, but they just don't hold up very well.
Okay.
It's kind of lackluster. It's kind of almost like they improved a couple things, but they dropped the ball on everything else. So.
So we're going to go into what you've been playing. You can go ahead and start, Mike. I think you have been playing DMC, right?
Yeah, so, Dragon Ball, I just said. Devil May Cry, I finally dove into it. I was bored, and I was like, alright.
Thank you for the friend request.
Yes. It's great, actually.
Okay.
I was surprised.
I'm not surprised. I heard it was good.
Well, you know what? I was huge on the first one.
Yeah.
I actually had brought it over the one time, and we played the crap out of it. Over 2 days, we beat it.
It's a great game.
You know, it's a great game. I loved it. The second one
aged
was...
Also.
Yeah, it actually did age very well.
Very well, yeah.
The second one was awful. 1970? What?
You need to... I think I told you, maybe I didn't, but if you want to add Movie Man 1970, he can't add you, I think, because you're on PS3.
Okay.
He wants you to add you as a friend, he can't.
Okay. The second one was... And the third one did all right.
Yeah.
The fourth one was... I played a little bit. It was just boring.
Yeah, boring me too.
I wanted to like it, but I couldn't. And then, so this came out, and I was like, I'm not even going to give it my time. You know, and so I avoided it, but then I went into it, and I like it. It's weird because of the style that they choose.
Yeah.
You know, you're not always, like in the Devil May Cry series, you're just, you have Dante or Virgil, depending on which game it was, and you're in the world, and you're just fighting creatures and everything like that. In this one, there's the real world, and there's Limbo, and you don't fight creatures in the real world.
I heard the artistic direction of Limbo is really awesome.
Phenomenal! It's great, and I don't like when they put I think it's cool when they put one composer in charge of all the music.
Yeah,
you know, it's a band, not like a composer itself. You know, it's cool. It kind of got a little repetitive. It's getting annoying now, but like you just hear this like dark metal kick up out of nowhere, and it's kind of cool because you know you're in limbo and know something's happening.
Yeah.
But you have to remember how long some of these battles with these creatures last. So it's like really annoying, it's really repetitive.
Yeah.
But I'm liking the story. The story's actually sounding pretty interesting. It's kind of like a take on, cultural America, almost like in the way that Grand Theft Auto did.
Okay.
So it kind of makes fun of, society and
how's the events. Combat system?
Combat is great, and
is
I love it. And you know what's cool is, like, in the first one, you had to switch between, you had your, sword, and then you had the Ifrits, and everything like that. In this one, you have your sword, you have the Rebellion, and then you have, you hold down the right trigger, and now you have your axe,
yeah.
And then the left trigger is the scythe. So those are your three weapons, and you can upgrade them each individually with different combos and moves. but it's actually made so that you can string together combos. So you have a bunch of different combos you can do with your sword, which you can string together with the combos you can do with your axe, which you can string together with that, which you can string together with combos from your pistols now,
yeah,
because you can upgrade your pistols for combos and everything. So it's really cool to, you know, see.
When it was releasing, that was the fear that they weren't at 30 frames per second and whatnot, they weren't going to be able to do the combat justice, but people don't give Ninja Theory enough credit.
No.
They are a very good developer.
They are very good, and it looks great.
Yeah.
It looks phenomenal. So
I mean, Heavenly Sword, yeah, it was really short, but
right.
Good for the length that it went, the six hours.
Anybody that's a fan of Devil May Cry, and anybody that has never played a Devil May Cry game, play it. Especially if you're having PlayStation Plus, if you still have a PS3, go, you know, put it in there if it's already in your thing and you just haven't played it yet. Play. It's actually
and on top of that, Enslaved. I never played it, but again,
yeah,
Ninja Theory
really good.
Has a pretty solid track record so far, because I heard Enslaved is actually a really good game. It was one of those kind of dark horses, I guess they call it. Just people didn't expect it to be good, and they didn't give it time of day, and then it came out, and then people gradually started getting to it, and then like, this is actually a really good game, and it kind of word of mouth helped a little bit. But yeah, that's another one from PS3 that I think people didn't give them credit for. So Ninja Theory, I would love to see them come back to Sony and do like a Heavenly Sword again. Where am I?
Sorry, that's on YouTube. That's our closing music.
Okay. I was wondering what that was going on there. Okay, I know what I've been playing.
So you've been playing.
I've been playing two games. I've been playing Outlast, and I've been playing it with Kristen. Actually, why don't you talk about Outlast a little bit first?
I think there should be rats.
Yes. It is a little unrealistic. You're in this asylum that's like all dirty and messed up, and you're in the basement and stuff, and there's like no rats. Rats. It's like, where are
there
the
rats? There should be rats, there should be cats with hats. No, just kidding.
This is our biggest complaint about the game.
I think there should be like mice and stuff that scamper at your feet and like scare you, and you think someone's coming, but it's a rat, you just hear like a rat. Yeah. I think it would add creepiness. But then Greg says there's rats.
He's been saying the whole game.
Yeah.
Okay, maybe we haven't gotten to that point yet.
And yeah, it does, I don't know if a gun, but something to stun them so they can't come at you.
But you understand the fear.
It's the thrill. It's like, oh my god, they're going to get me. But it just would make my anxiety like go down.
That's the point.
I know, but I'm just saying. It's not a complaint, it's just something personal.
Makes me really want to play Evil Within.
Yeah. Now this is like her first time really getting into like a two-stick control game,
which is funny because I did watch you. I don't know if Drew told you I watched a little bit last night.
No, it's fine. She's learning, but you're getting better. You are getting better.
I learned that the one joystick controls head, and the other one controls feet.
It sounds terrible to say, but she did learn that.
And I can do both.
Yeah, she's starting to, like, you know, she's doing 10 controls for a while. She's moving and then rotating. But like, I'm starting to see her starting to do it.
That's what I noticed, because I don't know if he told you, I was watching you last night for a few minutes. And it was at the part where you like kind of backed yourself in the corner, but you were like staring at the ground for like 2 minutes.
Yeah.
And I'm like, Kristen, look the fuck up.
Yeah. Like, she gets her head down too low or too high sometimes.
And then you got freaked out by the guy, so you turned your camera off.
Yeah.
No, you gotta save battery. Oh my god, they're picking on me.
Why?
You guys are picking on me, not Ben.
No, I'm not
picking on you. I thought it was funny.
For guys that make a girl play that game, I think, you know, I should get credit.
No, I'm
gave you a lot of credit. It was entertaining to watch.
And you're getting better. And you know what? Like, it was good, too.
You did better than Danny.
Thanks, Greg.
Let me get that from Ben. You'll make a noise with that.
I liked it, but I don't know. It's a little too dark. I know it's supposed to be like that, but
yeah, I mean, we're making you play just because I think it's
fun. I think it was
to
fun
see your reactions.
Right. That's really
it's not the best game for you. Yeah, I think we'll admit that. God, what was I gonna say though? But like, you know, she was playing, and I took the controller from her at one point, and just to help her out, and she asked for it back after I was done. Yeah. So you know, like I was proud of that. That you actually asked for the controller
back.
Yeah, she wanted to play. She took the controller back from me. And I was like, all right, cool. That's good. So hopefully I can keep you playing certain games.
Yeah.
I still want you to play Gone Home.
I am interested if I can get past, you know, trying to make both thumbs work with my brain.
That's the hope, though, is if once you get to that point where you feel comfortable with it, that you'll start playing more and more of these types of games.
Maybe I will.
Maybe. So I also been playing Outlast. I can speak a little more about it than she has, because she's not reading the documents and all that kind of stuff. She's just kind of playing to play it. You know, it's about a guy going into an asylum to investigate it after getting a hint or something like that. It's not very compelling from a gameplay perspective, or I'm sorry, from a story perspective. But I do think it does a lot of interesting things with the gameplay. I do like the little like touches, like being able to peek around corners, while you're running, you can look behind you and see the guy chasing you. Like, the little touches like that are things that I haven't seen in survival horror before.
Right.
That I think do add to the fear and, like, the cinematic approach to the game. Obviously, the night vision is the big thing that they're, they're pushing with the camera and whatnot. And on top of that, when you're recording things, that you start putting things in your notebook based on what you've recorded. It's got some neat touches for sure. I have no idea how long the game is.
Apparently it's only like 4 hours.
Like 4 hours? Okay, so I'm probably like 25% done, or maybe a little more than that. I'm definitely going to finish it. I'm enjoying it. And maybe survival horror, just like, you know, I don't play too often. I play Dead Space, and I really like Dead Space.
I'm surprised. I didn't think that was your style.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Typically, survival horror isn't really, it's not the fear or anything like that. Like, I'm not, like, afraid to be scared. Mm-hmm. It's just, like, I start to lose interest, actually, a little bit. Like, the game is entirely focused around scaring you.
Crap out of you.
Yeah.
Which is why I think 4 hours is perfect for this.
Yeah, and I agree with that.
I have something else to add.
What?
If he didn't tell me where to go, I would just get lost.
Yeah, it is. It can be a little bit of a maze.
I don't know how he finds where you're going.
Yeah.
Like, I have no idea. I would just run.
Drew's an architect. He has to plan everything out in his head.
It is dark, and you can get lost very easily.
I would get so lost.
Yeah. The other game I've been playing is Killzone.
Yeah.
Finally, it took a big hiatus from it. Just because I wasn't that impressed with it. I was on the second chapter, and I just kind of stopped. And then I just started up again, and I'm happy that I did, because right around the middle, around like chapter 3, 4, 5, 6, it picks up, for sure. It does some cool stuff.
Mosebius
Design.
Everyone, don't forget to smile.
Andrew Midori, architect. but there was a specific chapter 4, for instance, where you're in space, and you're doing anti-gravity stuff, but then what's really cool is you're really getting really close to the sun, and the ship starts to fall apart, and sun starts to come through, and is burning things, and the ship is melting around you, and the enemies, if they go into the light, burn. It's actually pretty cool scene, for sure. And then the chapter after that is also really cool, because there's a hell gas terrorist attack, and then the one that you've probably seen in the February reveal, where the bomb goes off.
Right.
But then they are trying to do a big explosive attack on a train. And you're going from train to train, going through them, going on top of them, going below them, like jumping from one to the other. And it was cool. Like, it was a very cool scene.
Right.
So I'm actually starting to enjoy it a lot. And I'm trying to think of the chapter after that. Chapter after that, you go into Helgan. For the first time, where you actually go over the wall, and you go in as a refugee, kind of taking
in the slums.
Yeah, and you're kind of tricking them, and then you have to kind of explode like a surge grenade on the train, and you disable it, and then you go out, and there's a really cool mission where you're with the one girl. She's a half breed, actually. She's half Helgan and half human, and she's actually neither side. She's trying to play both sides and doesn't want this war to happen at all.
Right.
She recognizes, as I think a lot of people should, that there's no real guilty person in this scenario. The Helgan were kind of actually the victims in a lot of ways, and now they're just fighting back. And now it's just a war between two sides that are just both trying to survive.
Yeah.
So there's no real villain in a sense. It's just two sides trying to survive. And she's trying to push that. And she's a really cool character because she snipes for you and you mark enemies and she snipes them. It's starting to just kind of click with me.
Okay.
I still have a little bit problem with the map design. I think I think that it's a little too open. It's a little too many markers sometimes where they don't direct you quite enough. Actually, that sounds terrible, especially when it comes to like difficulty versus accessibility. But I do think it's a little too indirect, actually, to the point where the maps are quite large sometimes, and you can get lost, and it just gets a little frustrating sometimes. You want to have a little bit of a more direction when it comes to the markers. A lot of times you have markers that are just high or low or over here, but in order to get to that marker, it's like I got to go down these steps and then turn around entirely and go back that way and then go up these steps. So really the markers don't help you in any way sometimes. You're just kind of trying to find your way, and sometimes you get four markers on the screen all at once.
Which stinks because you we're so used to in shooters being like streamlined, and going down, on rails is what they're
called. My most hated chapter in the game is the forest level for that reason. I thought the forest level was way too
Is that the one
non-linear.
That I played with you?
Yeah, I thought it was way too non-linear.
I
like
just, that, though.
I did not like that. I like non-linearity. And I think that they got that with a lot of the middle chapters, like 3, 4, 5, 6, stuff like that. but they need to kind of keep it a little bit more direct here and there. But for sure, much better than I thought it was going to be. After coming off 2 and 3, I really liked both 2 and 3's single player campaigns. I thought this one was a step down. I'd say right now, like the middle chapters, like 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, are just as good. The beginning started slow, and I heard the end kind of declines as well.
Really?
But the middle, I'm happy with. I'm very happy with the middle.
That's a little disappointing, but
yeah, we'll see what happens. But, you know what? I've been liking it more and more as they go along, so hopefully it kind of continues that trend. So yeah, definitely good.
You doing your boss from the past?
Why don't you do? Well, you're on the spot first.
No? Oh, we're on the spot? Yeah, we can do that. So on the spot. So I've been thinking.
Yeah.
With the glorious weather that we've been having, that I know everybody is loving, especially today as well, on top of everything else. What is your favorite childhood memory where it revolves around snow?
Okay, I immediately have this. Yeah. Should I go first?
Do you have one?
No, Drew can go first.
Okay, got it. Yeah.
Blizzard of 96, sure.
Okay.
Right off the bat. We got about 3 feet of snow.
Right, I remember.
But what was so awesome about it is our snowplow took, we have a development, not a big one, but relatively big.
You live here all your life,
yes.
Right?
Yeah, okay. He went throughout the whole entire development, and he put every bit of snow in our court, in the center. He made a circle around it, and he made on purpose. He made a mound like 40 feet high of snow. I'm not even joking right now.
That's awesome.
We were off that entire week, so we made this thing. It was amazing. Like, this was the coolest thing ever when we were children, obviously.
Right.
And then what happened?
That would be fucking awesome right now. Yeah, it would be. Children.
The sad part of this story, of course, is like the 16-year-old neighbor down the street comes in and he builds an enormous tunnel through the center of it, and then we couldn't go down anymore because all the parents were like, "It could collapse! It could collapse!" So he just completely ruined it for all of us. He made like a big, like literally like 6 foot tall, like walk-through tunnel through a enormous mountain of snow that could collapse on anyone. Like, yeah, not smart.
No.
So yeah, we had that ruined it for everyone. But at the beginning, it was awesome when we were like making it into a roller coaster.
That really creeped me out. Like, imagine that happening.
What, it collapsing on you?
Yeah,
yeah.
Just imagine just breathing in snow.
Yeah, that would be terrifying. Yeah, definitely. So, but that by far my best snow memory for sure.
But, okay. Hey, Deadpool's back.
Nice.
And is the real Batman back, too?
No.
Oh, you're the real Batman.
Okay. No.
I think Batman's not here.
Yeah, Batman is ditching us this week.
All right. Chris, do you have any
really
good snow stories?
Really?
Zero.
God, she elbowed him in the head again.
No, I hit his head as well.
Okay.
The only snow story that I really remember is our parents were outside shoveling, and I wasn't allowed out there. And then my friend was like, okay, well, if we be really bad, our parents will come in, and then they'll let us go out. So she kicked me in the face and knocked my tooth out, and I swallowed it.
Well, that is a snow story. That is definitely a story revolving around snow. Mark, do you have any yet?
It's either tied between building this elaborate, during the Blizzard of 96, building just this elaborate set. It started out as like one igloo with my two older brothers. Yep. And then we just gradually progressed down the front wall and building like separate lower patios, and it was just like this entire outdoor
snow fort, Charles.
It was basically a snow fort. It was just so cool because it was right next to the driveway, so all the snow from the driveways piled up on top. It got extra high.
Yeah, I mean, you think about it, 3 feet at the time. I mean, we were 8 years old.
Right.
We had to be like 4 feet tall.
Yeah.
We probably were barely out of that snow. That had to be awesome. I don't remember it well enough.
It was the worst plan ever.
That's funny.
But go ahead.
Yeah, I got kicked right in the face.
Oh. All right, so I don't have one particular one.
Okay.
Just because when I was trying to think of one, I have so many. Like, when I was a kid, snow was the perfect thing. So we had a great development. Have you ever been? Yeah, you used to come to my house.
Yeah.
So we were on that hill, and there's one house on the hill in particular where it's a huge hill like that, and then the whole street is a giant hill. So you were able to actually sled down that hill from that guy's house all the way down the street.
Yeah.
So that was awesome because you would literally go, and I mean, no one knows my street, but it's long.
Yeah.
How long would you sit?
And it's all downhill. Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about? Yep. The one guy with the. How long would you sit from Becker Machoney's house?
It's a long distance.
That's a long ways
that's
to go.
A nice sled ride.
So that was a nice fun ride, especially if you got all the way to the end, because most of the time you did, you hit a car. So like, it's really entertaining. But then actually that person's house I just said, she had a very good hill as well. So we would always go to her house. But the funny thing is that creek that runs behind our houses was right there. So if you did it well enough, we actually would pack like, you know, snow ramps and everything with our sleds. So you'd fly off them, but a couple times if you went really fast, you'd actually land in the water and you would skate across the water with your sled. So That was actually really.
Who has the best snow story?
Yeah, we want to hear from you.
Before you call in, actually, if anyone wants to call in, maybe get one caller with a really good snow story. We'll move on, but still.
It has to be the best one.
But if you guys here has the best.
Have a really good snow story, please call us on Skype, the Level Up Show. Audio only, please, as Mark just put. We'd love to hear a really good snow story.
Right.
Do you want me to go into while
yeah,
we.
Dear, I...
Go ahead, yeah, I'll do my blast from the past real quick. I want to talk about like an arcade title actually from when I was younger. Does anyone remember Alien Crush? I don't think you would, Mark.
No.
Yeah, Alien Crush. It might have been multi-platform. Double J Rock. We're from New Jersey, actually. It was for TurboGrafx, but it might have been a multi-platform game. It was the first pinball game I ever played, and it was actually kind of dark and like real like moody. It was it had very alien Ridley Scott aliens feel, and it was all about like you had to like shoot yourself into like aliens' mouths.
Ah!
Kristen was just attacked by the dog.
Oh God, he bit my leg so hard.
Oh, it's like Family Guy.
Anyway,
but this game was really cool at the time for me because you only had like two screens, right? You could shoot up onto the above screen or below screen. Let me see if I can actually get like the YouTube going here for a sec. And then you also had all these hidden probably four hidden areas where you'd have like mini games using the pinballs that you have to shoot. I really want to play the music. The music was really good. Where's YouTube? While we wait for Mike, who's currently taking a piss.
Hey!
What? Am I not allowed to say
that?
It's okay. It's not a big deal.
Look how sad I am.
Sad Batman.
Don't I look so sad?
Alright, here we go. Let's play some Alien Crush.
Live violence. Yeah, that is nice.
Yeah. Did anyone say they played it yet on here? Anyone play Alien Crush or Devil's Crush? The only thing was a sequel. This is the music from it right here.
Our clock is mirrored.
Very cool music. It was tough though. Like, it was one of those games like where no matter what, you couldn't dodge falling into like the pit every now and then. It just happened. TurboGrafx had a lot of great memories for me because that was my first. I should be able to see if I can play this on the screen for you guys. This is Alien Crush.
Yes, this is a video game show.
That's the title screen in reverse, mirrored. Ooh, Ghost Game fell through a frozen pond.
Oh, no.
Does anyone remember this game?
Oh! Oh, yeah, yeah. How can you not remember that? Or wait, something similar.
You might have played Demon Devil's Crush or something. This is Alien Crush. Awesome music. I'm showing off Alien Crush right now. It was an awesome game. Awesome music. Oh god. Alrighty. Now that we have Mike back, you can do your rant. I'm gonna pause this. I need to look up the song that you had planned because I needed to use YouTube.
Oh damn it.
Sorry.
I'm gonna search it again.
What is it? What's it called?
I'll get it again. Don't worry.
Okay, you got it at the end?
Yeah, I'll get it at the end.
So you have a rant this week.
I do. I actually don't even feel like ranting. It stinks, because that's actually the funny part when I actually want to rant.
You need to rant.
I need to rant. Alright. So, I'm getting kind of annoyed. We actually even touched on this a little bit last week, just with something that happened. But I even actually touched on this a little bit in a different form a few weeks ago with my first rant, where I, you know, complained about the attitudes of gamers in general, you know, and our attitude towards others, and we need
to be specifically fanboyism.
Specifically fanboyism, but, you know, as gamers, we really need to unite because there's a lot of people that are against us already as it is.
Yeah.
And we're not really doing very much to help ourselves.
We're looked at as a childish, immature industry.
And we are. We're very childish. We're very immature. Yeah. Especially when it comes to this next topic. And it's been blowing up the whole thing the whole time tonight, too.
Yeah.
You know, even though we've been on 11 times, it's still happening. It happened earlier this week with my friend. You know, it happened earlier, actually, this afternoon with my friend, you know, when I was actually there with her. You know, it's getting really annoying, this whole attitude we have towards girls gamers. you know, Kristen, you know, is a gamer. And not even the strictest sense, but she's a gamer. But when
the
we
fact
come
that
here,
I do this show with you guys makes me a gamer.
No, it just makes you that.
A
yeah,
loser.
It makes you the loser.
Yeah.
Just like us.
But she used to be a much bigger gamer, but she does play
right.
games here and there now.
But
so.
It's really annoying. Like, when you go on Call of Duty or anything like that, the moment that a girl speaks on one of those things, everybody just blows up. People's ways of playing the game completely changes. You have a guy that's on their team that's, you know, letting himself get killed for her. They become martyrs. And it's just guys being pathetic, you know, almost, you know, cliche pigs in a way. And it's really getting annoying. You know, we had the call earlier from Fleecy. And I don't know if you even noticed it. Me and you, it was a great call. She had some great points that she brought up. It was a great conversation. What the hell is that? But the whole room, anything in the chat for the next, you know, 10 minutes, people were going on like, hey, Fleecy, great questions. Hey, Fleecy, that was awesome. And it's just like, dude, it's a girl. Matt called. No one said anything about what Matt said.
Yeah.
And Matt had some good things he brought up. The guy Jason that called, he had some great things he brought up.
It was
up
a good call, that, from Fleecy.
Sledgehammer. Oh, it was a great call, but we get that all the time. And no one says, hey, great call, this person. It's because it was a girl that it happened. We need to stop being so pig-headed and one-minded that we see, oh my god, there's a girl! They're the greatest things in the world! Guess what? They're girls, they have boobs, but they play games just as like we did. There's no reason to get all uppity. It doesn't mean that they're going to like you just because they play games. It's almost like they feel like they have more of an accessibility factor to them. And they don't. They're just as weird and dumb and crazy as we are, but it's just, oh my god, it's just so annoying that people get that hung up on the fact that it's a girl game.
This is something to discuss as well. Girls take advantage of it now too, because
there's a lot of girls that do, and so that's not who I'm talking to. You guys are digging your own holes. I'm talking to people like Kristen that want to get in there and want to play games.
Yeah.
You know, people, like, I have other friends that do this all the time, that they can't even feel comfortable playing games. There's a lot of people that don't even go on the mic. You know, a lot of girls would never go on the microphone, you know, just because they don't want to have to deal with that crap.
Yeah.
And it's just getting so annoying that, you know, us as gamers, I don't act like that. I know you don't act like that. I know Mark doesn't act like that. Why? Because we're grown up and we're not actually completely stupid in a net as far as being social. You know, it's something that, you know, we just...
I know, and sorry to jump in on your rant. You're talking about...
No, go ahead.
Like, the idea of people coming in and being like, oh my god, go call Fleecy because she's a girl. But then there's also the complete other side of that, where if you're in Halo and a girl who has a very obvious girl gamer tag comes in, just the language and stuff that girl will immediately receive is just, it's just it's disgusting. I can't even say it.
Right.
Ting!
Yeah. It's just, it really is how quickly it happens.
Right.
And it's just like, oh my god, like,
right,
grow
it's
up.
Almost depressing,
yeah,
in a way. You know, we've gotten this far, we've been gaming this far, and yet we still act like that. You know, everybody tries to say, oh, you know, gamers aren't some nerdy, you know, guys that, you know, can't get girls. We act like it, and I don't want to say we because I know I don't, and I know you don't, and I know Mark doesn't, but we have to, unfortunately, combine ourselves into one motion if we're going to say this, because gamers as a whole have this whole, you know, really poor outlook on what happens when a girl approaches them. They think that they have this accessibility to them, and they don't. They're just like, you know, they wouldn't say anything like this at
Bogey's
a bar.
Bogey's watching.
Yeah, Bogey loves watching, right?
Can I interrupt?
So
the girls always say sexy girl playing that stuff.
No,
you're
right.
You're right.
They
take
advantage
of it.
There's people that take
advantage
of it, and there's some people that take advantage of it almost as the farce that it is. You know, we have a viewer,
yeah,
and someone that we watch that does it in a joking way, I think.
Yeah.
You know, from what I've seen her say and everything like,
yeah,
that on her show, because I've watched it,
yeah,
a few times since. And, you know, she does it because she knows what it gets. She doesn't,
yeah,
want to be that girl, but she knows that it gets the viewers.
It does. It bothers me a little bit because that furthers it even further. I mean,
right. I know, I get that, but the problem is, it's just, you know, if you have a girl and, you know, someone actually just brought up about clans. I didn't even read half of that comment. I just saw something about girls joining a clan. You know, in Call of Duty, when they have clans are something that you can take serious if you really want to get in the game. But when they have a girl in the clan, you know, half the time that girl sucks horribly. She's the loudest,
like,
and most
that
annoying player ever.
Stanley Stacy says, I never say anything sexy, I just want to kill. Well, you're
awesome.
Our type of girl then. That's awesome. That's what girls should be more like. They shouldn't be...
Every girl
advantage.
Should be more like Saintly Stacy.
Yes, kill.
I say something.
Go ahead, yeah.
I just wanted to tell everyone that I went home this weekend and I brought back my first console, the Super Nintendo.
Which we're trying to figure out how we're going to hook up.
Because you don't have the cords?
No,
we have it,
cords.
But it's a coaxial cable hookup.
Really?
Yeah, it doesn't even have composite hookup.
And this was my favorite game as a child, Super Mario All-Stars. And I'm sure everyone remembers having to do this.
Which you're not supposed to do.
Oh, well, it works.
Yeah, I know it does.
And then you stick it in the hole.
Uh-oh.
And that's how
it
works.
It went there.
It went there.
You brought it there.
And I have Donkey Kong, The Lion King, Aladdin, Super Mario, and just the list goes
all
on.
Solid games.
And I love Super Nintendo forever. Better than PS4 and Xbox. The end.
I don't think that's actually too, you know,
that's fine.
Controversial of opinion
right
now.
I'm okay with it.
Certainly, Super Nintendo is one of the best consoles
right
ever made. It has a huge library of games.
I know that wasn't really an angry rant. I wasn't really.
No,
it,
you know,
it.
It's a truth though. It really is.
It really is. It's really getting pathetic and annoying.
You're speaking
you know
truth facts right there.
I am, but it's not the funny rant that I think people wanted. It was just kind of.
Yeah, I mean, not the rant that people wanted, but you know, guys.
Deserved.
Yeah. Treat girls the way they deserve to be treated.
That was bad. I was hoping you were going to go something better than that.
No, it's the truth. Like,
no, but yeah, it's
don't feed into it. You know, like
right.
Just like we can change this still.
Right.
It's not too
and
far
people,
gone.
You kind of brought it up, and someone else brought it up. You know, they don't have to announce that they're girls. And some of the girls that are going there, you know, it's like Girl Gamer 54 or something
yeah
like that. It's like okay, now you know that they're trying really hard.
Yeah.
But I have friends, you know, and if they put their name on everything like that, and their name is like Liz. Obviously, you're going to know it's a girl, but they're not doing it, you know, to try. And they don't, you know, I have actually, you know, one of Katie's friends, actually, she's really into it. She was really good at it.
Yeah.
Actually. And, you know, but she didn't, you know, go on like one of those classic girls, but people just, she would have to leave rooms half the time because people wouldn't play right.
Yeah.
You know, so.
All right, cool. That was Mike's rant. Not as angry as usual.
Not as angry as usual. I'm just not feeling angry today. I'm in a good mood.
It was very parent-y.
Yeah.
Yeah, you kind of sound a little bit like a dad.
Add us on Twitch.
Yeah.
Add us on Twitter or anywhere you would like to add us.
I think I may have lose viewers.
Yeah. No, I don't think so. I think it's just
yeah. No, I don't want
no,
to.
No, I think
that
it's just up and down. I like Greg's comment earlier. Greg said that girls are the poop.
Okay.
I like that. He decided not
some,
to curse.
Not all girls, some girls.
Which is weird for Greg.
Just girls are the poop.
Yeah.
I like it.
Okay.
Some girls.
It took me a second. I thought he said girls are poop, and I was like, oh, Greg. But then I realized he said girls are the poop.
I wish I could
Guys, if you want to Skype us, it's the Level Up Show, spelled
right
exactly how it sounds. We can talk about girl gamers. We can talk about...
I want to say something.
Oh, your best snow story?
I wish that we could stream the... was that Super Nintendo?
Yeah, I mean, I would love to be able to stream.
I would love.
Okay.
You could see how good
yeah
I am at Super Mario if you could watch me stream. I am a beast at Super Mario.
Extremely talented gamer girl, and she quit using Mike. And
yeah,
it makes perfect
happens
sense.
All
it happens
time
all the time.
Thanks.
And it's unfortunate because there are a lot of girl gamers out there, actually. So let's go into our topic of the week: difficulty versus accessibility. Actually, how about we start a little video on this? How about that?
We have an informative video.
No, I'm saying like we'll record this part of the show.
Meet Timmy. Timmy is a gamer.
Our topic of the week this week is difficulty versus accessibility in games. We're kind of talking about the handholding that you might see pretty often in
or
lack games
thereof.
Or maybe lack thereof, but that, I feel like that's a little bit
the
of
extreme
a response
really
to the handholding.
Yes, I agree.
I think obviously we're talking about Demon's Souls, Dark
right
Souls, which kind of started this trend that I don't think anyone saw coming.
Right.
It just kind of happened. They decided to make a very difficult old school game, and people grabbed onto that because
right
they hadn't seen it in so long.
So, I mean, one of the things that brought I thought our conversation we had when we were playing Brothers is what brought up this topic. But you were saying something that Mark had.
Yes.
You know, so I'll bring up that at first. You know, when we were playing Brothers, and I was saying it was getting annoying. It was kind of interesting how, you know, we were playing this game, and we went on the hang gliding part, whatever,
yep,
and I was saying it was kind of annoying that, you know, I didn't know I had to do this and this, and then when I thought about it, you know, after about 20 seconds, I was like, wait a minute, do I really need to be shown that? You know, I remember games that, you know, I would play forever that I didn't know how to do something, you know, for days on end, and I finally figured it out, but there was no, you know, explanation of, oh, you have to do this to do this.
Yep.
But now you have games, like, I remember when I was playing Mario and Luigi Dream Team.
Yeah.
I couldn't play it. I couldn't finish it. I had to stop because it was telling me how to do everything.
Yep.
There was no game to it. It was almost like reading a game. You know, it was awful.
I feel like kind of a different example of this is actually Final Fantasy XIII.
Okay.
Now, they weren't trying to... the game wasn't like overly difficult, and they weren't trying to handhold you for that reason.
Right.
It's just like these games have large battle systems.
Right.
They're very involved. It took 25 hours for the full battle system to become available
to
you.
Yeah, right.
The first 25 hours of that game are a tutorial.
Yeah.
The entire first 25
hours. Up until
hours
you get to the open field.
Pretty much, yes.
Yeah.
That's where you finally have freedom to use all your party members, to use all the abilities that
right
have been taught to you for the first 25 hours. This could have been done in 5 hours. Like,
you think so?
Yes, easily. Anyone who plays Final Fantasy could have had this done in 5 hours. The problem is that they were trying to market this game to people that had not played Final Fantasy. They were doing this whole Western marketing thing, trying to get hold of people that...
Well, Lightning is the best character ever developed for a Final Fantasy game.
Well, you know what? It's kind of sad that Japan actually has her on the top of the list, pretty much. They really like Lightning over there. I like Lightning too. She's a little monotone, and she didn't deserve three games for sure. But that's not my problem with Final Fantasy 13. The problem is that it takes 25 hours to really get going. I enjoyed the first 25 hours. I'm not saying I didn't. It's just it felt like it was in restraint mode the entire way through. It's like, I can do this, guys. Like, give me the things I want to use. Like, why am I waiting for this to come? Like, it was really frustrating to someone who's played the series from the beginning. So I feel like that's part of it. I feel like this difficulty versus accessibility has a lot to do with trying to get games in the hands of people that don't typically play these types of games, which is unfortunate to people like us who just want to play the games. Right. Like, you know, it's like these are people that love your games. Like, you should be catering to us more than anyone else. So maybe the solution is they need to figure out a way to do both at the same time.
There's an easy way solution.
Yes. Yeah.
And it's called difficulty modes.
Yes.
And you have one that's the hardest difficulty.
Yeah.
You have usually the extreme, the one that they don't recommend unless you've beaten the game already. The hard difficulty, which is normally what you would want to play, you know, in order to get the full true experience. The normal, which is what I end up usually playing just so I can experience it in a good amount of time.
Yeah.
Easy, and then hand-holding your bitch way.
Yeah.
Which is
and some of these games do this. I don't want to say that they don't, but
there's not enough.
A really cool thing that I haven't seen personally, and I'm sure has happened before, is have it so that the tutorial mode is only in the easy mode.
Yes.
If you're on normal or above, they don't do any tutorial, or maybe they do less tutorial or something like that. Maybe it even says like as a caption below, hard mode. This mode has no tutorial. You know what I mean? Like there is no help mode. There's nothing to describe the functions of the battle system. You are figuring this out on your own. A good example of that is Don't Starve, which some people have a problem with, and I love. Right. I love that you're thrown into that world, have no explanation on what to do, no idea on what makes this or what makes that, or where to go for this item or that item, or how this item is made. It's just die, relearn, die, trial, error, over and over again. You know, until you get to day 50 and die, and then try again. You know, like, it's just, that's the essence of that game. Dark Souls is another kind of similar comparison to that. Minecraft is a little bit of that,
even. Minecraft, which, you know what, and that's really weird to me, because you have all these, you know, things saying, Minecraft, you know, we have to handhold all these kids, we have to show them how to do these games, especially that Mario and Luigi one. Man, that really pissed me off so much. But then you have games like Minecraft, which is blowing up for all kids, all young kids, and they're getting the hang of it really easily. So obviously you don't have to hold your hands. No. You don't have to do it. No. They just feel like they want to because we won't understand it. You know, we're not stupid. Kristen's a sad panda.
It's just your little face above.
That's the point.
Do you want to sit here so people can see you?
I mean,
you don't have to.
Comfortable.
I'm taking breaks and going up and back.
She looks very comfortable where she is. So
I can't sit on this chair for hours.
Oh, God, where was I?
This chair hurts.
Uncharted. Let's talk about Uncharted. This is an example of a game that is all about the cinematic experience.
Mm-hmm.
It handholds you to, in a sense, because it wants to guide you through a movie of sorts.
Right, which like Tomb Raider
it's telling
did as
a
well
story
and stuff like that. Yeah.
I think a good thing about Uncharted is you can turn off the hints. You can put it on extreme mode. Last of Us is another really good example of that, being that if you go on hard or extreme, you have an entirely new gameplay mechanic in no listen mode. Or the lack of a gameplay mechanic, which really changes the game, which is kind of cool because you have two different playthroughs in a sense. That's good. I like that kind of stuff. You know, I'm glad that they didn't just take that out entirely because the focus testing told them that people didn't like not being able to see where enemies are. They're like, well, this is the vision that we had, so we'll put it on hard extreme and let the people that want to play it that way play it that way. And it was a better game that way, I think. You played it on no listen as well, didn't you, Mark? Last of Us I'm talking about?
No, I didn't get that far into it, unfortunately.
I think it's a better game that way, and I think that's the vision that they had.
I don't think I would like it as much, though.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I don't know. I
like the scarcity of the ammo. I felt like that fit in with what the world was supposed to be.
Right.
But it's just... Where do we go from here?
where do we go from here?
Yeah, like I'm trying to think. Like, okay, Demon's Souls and Dark Souls kind of started a thing right now.
Devil May Cry even has a great way of doing it. Like at the beginning of Devil May Cry, you know, there's a lot of different battle mechanics and everything like that, and you're showing some of them. You know, you are held in the hands, but you know, some of them. It's kind of cool where you're running through this one area and you walk up to something and it kind of does like a little bubble. And if you remember like Super Mario World, where when you first, you know, you can hit the little, you know, raspberry fruit things, you know, and it tells you the hint, but if you don't need to hit, you don't have to hit it.
Yeah.
So that's actually a perfect way of doing it. Let me walk up to something. Let me get to something that will tell me quickly without stopping my gameplay. It's when it stops my gameplay that really pisses me off. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm trying to flow with it.
I saw a Celtics fan say that there needs to be a return to the glory days of like single-player PS1 titles. And I completely agree with this. I've never been a multiplayer guy. Mm-hmm. I would love to go back to the days of just this single-player focused story campaign with no multiplayer bringing it down.
Here's the problem. We're already pretty much there in a way.
Sometimes,
one of the biggest issues that people are having with games right now is you went from having single-player games, a lot of single-player games like that, what you're talking about, but a lot of games where you could do couch co-op, and now you have no games that you can do couch co-op.
Yeah.
It's hard. There's like, I can literally probably count all of them on my hands.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's gone towards online multiplayer, mm-hmm. and there's obviously a space for that, but I think you're seeing, it's just a diverse market now with indie, right. especially, that you are seeing a return to that kind of stuff. You're seeing these single-player focused experiences. The Order is going to be one of them. That's not an indie title, but I'm happy to see that Naughty Dog and now Sony Bend, maybe possibly, and Ready at Dawn, who's working on The Order, they're focusing on single player. They're trying to tell a story.
Right.
And a lot of people have a problem with that. Quantic Dream is another one. A lot of people have a problem with games trying to tell a story, but there is definitely an audience
market
for that.
If you don't like that type of game, if it's one game and it's bad, we have no problem saying it's a bad game. But if you just don't like that genre, then just don't play it.
Yep.
It's not saying you don't have to play every game out there. You know, I'm sure there's a ton of people that don't play sports games and stuff like that. You know, you don't have to play every game made. You know, it's just that, you know, it's there and there's an audience. And I actually like stuff like that. Heavy Rain was one of my favorite games.
Super Sosa, do you have a question? I keep saying we're ignoring questions.
Yeah.
If you have a question, Super Sosa, say it. And if you see it, Mark, just point it out to me. If you see a question from Super Sosa. But anyone, I would kind of want to hear what people have to say. I wish they would call in more.
WWE 2014.
I can't speak about WWE 2014.
I saw it a couple times. I'm not gonna lie, I didn't see the question. I just saw something about WWE.
I haven't played a wrestling game since like NWO Revenge.
We actually talked about this.
Yeah, I love that game.
Yeah,
but I don't play a lot of wrestling games, Super Sosa. Sorry about that. Does anyone have any comments they want to make on how they feel about difficulty or accessibility or the handholding that you might see in certain games? Like, how do you
it's
feel about it?
Things like Dark Souls, because they came in, you know, almost to combat, you know, all the handholding.
Let me open up Skype again, make sure you guys can call in. Sorry, it's Twitter. And then we're going to close up very soon, so this might be the end of it all.
Yeah.
Daryl tried to call 4 times. I must have missed that.
I think when you don't have the app open, it doesn't
work. Doug tried to call, too. Let me try calling Doug. See if Doug has anything to say.
He's been commenting, so it's actually an interesting conversation.
Yeah. Doug, answer the phone, Doug!
Doug!
Hey, guys.
Hey, man.
Hey, it's Doug!
Sorry to miss your call earlier. did you hear us talking about difficulty versus accessibility in games at all?
Yeah, actually, I was just paying attention to that. Kind of curious. I don't know if any of you guys play MMOs anymore.
I'm gonna get into it. You gotta remember, we never did. I sat there when you guys tried playing it the one time, and I just didn't bother. So Mark used to, but he stopped.
It sounds like Elder Scrolls Online might be one of the ones that we all try and get into. And then there's also Final Fantasy 14, which I'd love to get into. If it turns out that the first couple months are free or something, I'll definitely get out on that.
Yeah. Final Fantasy 14 was pretty good. Elder Scrolls is looking very, very good.
Yeah.
I kind of wanted to comment on, I guess, sort of the difficulty versus availability.
Yeah,
or whatever.
Sure.
With WoW. So most people consider WoW to have been going slightly. They're making it easier for people to get into, so on and so forth. They're starting this whole flex rating thing. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you fine. No problem, man. You're good.
Awesome. they're starting this whole flex rating thing, which is kind of cool, and it makes it easier for people to get into the game and actually start digging into the content. And what's nice is they present the story there with you, and it follows along pretty easily. But there's been a lot of backlash, like people like me stopped playing because it was really, really easy, so on and so forth. But they're sort of starting to come out with this nice compromise of this like heroic like content thing where it's just like you get better gear, it's dead set at this, you need this number of people, but then also allowing for this sort of flexible rating sort of thing. I think they might be coming up with a pretty decent balance for that. Do you guys see that happening anywhere else?
That's the thing, that's what we want to happen, but I don't really see it.
I think the reason we brought it up is there's just not enough companies that have a good idea on how to handle it overall.
It's almost just one or the other. You know, either have like a rogue game, which is all about dying and trial and error, or you've got this hand-holding type experience.
Like Super Meat Boy, God, that game was...
It's either one or the other, it feels like, and it's good to see that at least WoW is kind of forming a compromise of sorts. But, you know, it doesn't happen too often.
No.
It doesn't seem. That's the problem. And we're hoping that changes because and we were kind of saying that Dark Souls and Demon Souls may have started something up, you know, with this kind of return of high, like rolling difficulty as kind of being an attraction to a game. Now, Dark Souls 2, there's already rumors that it's going to have kind of been dumbed down, or maybe they're going to have a mode to dumb it down for the people that don't want that experience. But I'd be fine with that. As long as there's still the core experience that the Dark Souls, Demon Souls fans want, then there's no issue there, right?
Yeah. No, I think the big thing, the reason Dark Souls ended up being so successful was that you have a game that is inherently very, very difficult.
Right.
But it's not just random difficulty piled on top of you where you feel like you're just being like one shot or killed randomly. Like, you see the mistake you made and you know it was your fault and how to correct it.
Yeah. Definitely.
It's never that like, oh, there's just a million things flying at me, I'm going to die.
Yeah, that's totally the reward of that game is learning from your mistakes and correcting yourself. Same with Don't Starve. That's what is so attractive about those games.
It's not even necessarily difficult, it's just unforgiving.
Yeah,
you screw up, you're dead.
Yeah. Yes. Absolutely.
Yeah, definitely. All right,
I think it's going to be hard for developers to find a good balance of a way to make games difficult without making them impossible at certain points.
Yeah, that's what the whole focus testing, I guess, is for, but that's where you start running into problems, actually, is when you do focus testing, because those aren't the people that you
really
want to be focus
playing,
testing.
Right?
Yeah. So that's where the problems come. Thanks for talking to us, man.
Not a problem. I'll let you guys finish this up.
All right, see you, man.
Later.
Amazon, you dick.
All right, I'm going to call Daryl real quick, and I think we'll end on that.
Yeah,
hopefully
we'll
he'll call, or he'll take the call.
I think we should end with Greg calling.
yeah, I'll try calling Greg, maybe. It's like Daryl might have left us. All right, you want to try Greg?
Sure.
All right, we're going to try. This will be the last call, probably. But let's see if we can get a hold of Greg.
We're going to do our dance. If you want to join us.
Yeah. All righty, Greg.
Sounds good. Other than that, guys, it's been a good show.
Greg!
How are you?
What? What was that?
What was my AO, or did you miss it?
Oh, that was yours, I guess. That was an AO, okay.
Yeah, that was an AO.
AO! I guess you turned. Oh, we're getting another call from Daryl, of course. I just shut down the thing, and then Daryl calls. Alright. Greg, we wanted to call you before we shut down.
I love you guys more than my life. I'm sorry, Kristen, I don't know, I'm assuming she's just tired, but like, God bless, love you more than life. Mark, beanie swag all night, I appreciate that. and Drew and Mike, just really quick to touch upon the topic, I think it's really good that this topic got brought up, because then you guys spurred a whole bunch of conversation with this. Not only that, but to focus on like the MMO thing that, I forget what his name was, Doug?
Doug called it, yeah.
he made a great point in that it's different where you're looking at a game, because in the industry we have a lot of good games right now. We have games like Flower that you could go and just go for a game to get experience, and you have, like you said, Uncharted that has multiple game modes and stuff like that.
Right.
The one thing is where developers have a game like WoW, something that's going to be streamlined through over the course of multiple years. It's the same concept of the core game, but then they flip-flop it to where now they're switching from that experience going into something completely different. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. I don't know. I just wanted to reiterate his point, and I thought he made a valid argument.
Definitely. No, I agree. Yeah. Yeah, it's still a growth thing, I guess, and developers are figuring it out gradually. I guess WoW's, or I shouldn't say WoW, Blizzard, Activision is one of them. The industry is changing, and a lot of new people are coming into it. So they need to cater to a lot of like this new audience, but also not forget the people that built this industry.
Exactly. And it's right from a brain hole.
Yeah, it's a balancing act for sure. All right, man. Thanks so much. I'm gonna call Darren real quick because I feel bad. All right.
God bless. I'll see y'all
bye,
soon.
Nick.
Woo! See you, Greg.
Hey-o.
All right, Darryl, I'm gonna call you. I'm sorry. We should just call people from now on.
We should, that should be our new segment. Not only heard, we should just call random person that calls before.
Yeah.
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, we hear you, man.
Okay, I'm on my Xbox One, so I've never done this before.
Oh, cool. I like this. All right. Do you have anything to say about difficulty versus accessibility in games, Daryl?
I know one game. I can't think. Actually, it starts with Soul. I can't think of the second part of it.
Soul Sacrifice?
No. It's a really hard game. I can't get past the first 10 minutes of it.
That seems like an obvious answer, but Demon Souls or Dark Souls?
Dark Souls, that's
it. Okay. Yeah, that's exactly what the name of that game is. That's the point of that game, is that this unforgiving nature where you're learning from your mistakes, and that's the reward.
Right.
So I'm guessing you quit on it, though.
I'd stop playing it.
It's not for everyone, it's definitely not for everyone, but I like that there is that kind of genre now, almost of sorts, coming back. It's something that, like, Super Meat Boy is another example of it, but it was, when you were playing these old NES games that didn't have save systems, the reason that you had such longevity...
Mega Man 9.
Yeah, like Mega Man, the longevity from those games came from dying so often, having to start all the way from the beginning. Which is kind of a rogue type game then.
Right.
So they're bringing that back a little bit, and I think it attracts a lot of those old school gamers, which I guess is not for you, but is there any... So what do you think about like hand-holding, though? Do you think that some of these games are actually a little bit too hand-holdy?
Yeah, I think a lot of games should just let you kind of do what you want to do.
Yeah. Just throw you in.
Yeah.
Like Don't Starve.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is there any games you've played recently that kind of that you can think of that are too hand-holdy? Can't speak right now. Jesus.
Let's see. Not really too bad. I mean, Tomb Raider kind of is a little bit, but not, you know.
It's a little more linear than I think. It had this open world, but it's not open world. It's linear with like a big world. It's not open world, which is kind of what they advertised that, but it's not what that was. Yeah. But I think Tomb Raider was okay.
I was just going to say, Mike, Project Spark is actually looking pretty good.
Yeah?
Are you in on the beta?
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought so.
I for some reason, I didn't get my invite. I know you said that you got yours. I wanted to see it. I know, you know what? I got mine for... Are you using it on the PC or on your Xbox?
PC right now.
Okay, I wonder if they just didn't do it for Xbox. I got a PC invite.
Okay.
They haven't done the Xbox One yet. They did say, though, if you use your same... account through Windows with your Xbox One, you can use it on both.
Which I don't. So, I'm screwed with that. But no, I mean, I'm hoping it's good. Drew has no hope for that whatsoever, but I'm actually... you're not even shy about it. You're like, no.
Well, I'm not getting an Xbox One.
Right.
There's going to be a lot of microtransactions, though.
Yeah,
probably. It's a little bit of a Little Big Planet clone, but they're trying to take it a little further, it seems, which is cool. I'd like to see maybe if the same thing happens with Little Big Planet and they try and take that further as well, and maybe there's this competition that forms. That could be kind of cool. Sounds you got a lot to deal with over there, man. Thanks for calling, though.
Oh, no problem.
All right, take care.
Have a good night, man.
Bye.
Someone said Hotline Miami is another great example of the Die and Retry.
Die and Retry, yeah.
Yeah, that is. I play a little bit of that. That's a weird game, but very quirky and kind of like drive, like 80s style thing. Kind of creepy, actually.
Right.
But pretty cool.
That was a good show.
Yeah, definitely. Oh, you need to find that music real quick.
I do.
I'll do the final words here. Thanks for watching. This is the Level Up Show. This was episode 11. And if you guys want to add us, please do. Heart us on Twitch. You'll get notifications when we go live if you do that. Add us on Twitter. We kind of talk with you guys. We talk about what the topic of the week could be. If there's any schedule changes, we'll let you know.
Yeah.
Same with Facebook. Pretty much everything we do to Twitter goes to Facebook. Our blog, if we ever get reviews or editorials done, it'll go to our blog. And then finally, please add Mike or myself on PSN.
Yeah, we got a lot of friend requests tonight, so bear with us if we don't get to them right away.
I'll try right after the show.
Yeah. I can't get to everybody's because I only have the PS3.
For some reason, you can't read it. I am DrewM1788, and Mike is a noob guru.
Yeah.
Those are spelled pretty much exactly how they sound. There's no like zeros in the place of O's or anything like that. Nothing crazy.
I can spell correctly. Sorry, guys.
Yeah, definitely.
It's a good time.
Thanks again to Blue Ignosis for our new intro theme.
It's official now, and like I said, if you haven't already, email, get in contact with Drew. We're gonna figure out something to get you.
Yeah, definitely.
And don't forget, I mean, I don't know if anybody's still doing it, the artwork.
Yeah, if anyone wants to do artwork.
If anybody wants to do the artwork and anything like that, we put out before, said a couple times, so I don't know if anybody's doing it at all. Yeah. But you know, if you have anything for us and we like it enough, you know, we'll choose that as our official thing and we'll give you something just like we're gonna give Blue Ignosis. So.
Yeah, definitely.
But
So thanks so much for watching. I'm Andrew. This is Mike. This is Kristen. This is Mark. We're the Level Up Show.
Ready.
Next week we might start a little earlier, actually during The Walking Dead, and do like a little bit of like a live thing as The Walking Dead ends, and then we'll go into the show. Because this week we felt a little rushed.
Yeah, we were definitely right. We started late too.
Yeah.
So.
So thanks so much, guys, for watching us. Thanks for all the friend requests. You guys are awesome.
Oh, it's good.